It's pretty.
How was last night?
I don't have that.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the December 20th City of Portsmouth Planning Board meeting. The first order of business is a review of the capital improvement plan. Deputy City Manager, are you going to sort of introduce this or are you just going to kick it off?
I will do that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. And good evening. Tonight, we will be presenting the planning to the planning board the city's proposed six-year capital improvement plan for FY 20 through 2025. The process of developing this plan started this past summer when a memorandum was sent out to all department heads, including the schools and the Pease Development Authority, asking that they submit their capital needs for the next 6 years. Citizens were encouraged to submit project proposals via a form on the city's website. At the September planning board meeting, a presentation was given regarding the CIP process and schedule, and subsequently in November, the planning board held a CIP public informational meeting where citizens were encouraged to provide public input to the planning board. A few years ago, a complete overhaul of the capital improvement program was performed to better communicate the CIP process and document to the public. Each element sheet contains a priority level and a comprehensive checklist to evaluate the project. Five appendices are included in the CIP book itself. Those are a list of citizen requests, state projects that have no local dollars but will be done within the city's boundaries, a list of all studies used in evaluation of the project, a historic document restoration index, maps of each of the city's five wards with an index of each street, parks, city facility, water and sewer facilities that are located in each ward. The improvements to both the process and the product has assisted the public in understanding and to have more input into the capital improvement program. After the initial two presentations to the public at the planning board meetings this past fall, the planning board's CIP advisory committee, consisting of Chairman Dexter Legg, Vice Chair Elizabeth Moreau, and Jeff Kissel, met with the city manager and various department heads to review their requests. For FY 20, department heads submitted requests totaling $2.155 million that would directly affect the FY 20 general fund budget. Last year, the City Council approved funding at a level of $1.65635 million for these improvements during the FY 19 budget process. To avoid a constant dollar target for a capital improvement budget, which devalues over years, the city uses a policy to tie capital expenditures from the general fund to a percentage of the city's overall budget. Specifically, the city's goal is to allocate up to 2% of the prior year's general fund budget to capital projects. In the prior 6 years, the percentage has fluctuated from a low of 1.48% in FY 19 to a high of 1.97% in FY 17. The FY 19 enacted general fund budget is $113 million. Therefore, the capital expenditure target for FY 20 would be approximately $2.25 million. While the goal of the board has been to develop this capital improvement plan using a stable amount of the city's property tax revenues to fund capital projects, there is a realization that fiscal year to fiscal year increase also needs to be reasonable. With a FY 19 capital outlay of $1.635 million or 1.48% of the prior year's appropriations, the CIP Advisory Committee feels a gradual increase of capital outlay was prudent to eventually reach a goal of 2% of prior year's appropriations. After reviewing departmental capital project requests totaling $2.155 million, the CIP Advisory Committee reduced these requests by $345,000 and is recommending an appropriation of $1.81 million, or roughly 1.6% of the FY 19 budget. This funding is recommended to ensure the city can meet its obligation to maintain its infrastructure and quality of life for its residents. It should be noted that projects that are bonded require a separate vote of the City Council by a two-thirds margin. In addition, those projects identified in the out years of FY 21 through FY 25 are for planning purposes with actual funding not required in FY 20. The total capital improvement plan scheduled for FY 20 is $33,755,428, which would be funded by a variety of sources, including the general fund, bonding, enterprise funds, and state and federal grants, parking revenues, and other sources. At this time, I'd like to ask various staff members to present to you the details of the CIP for the period 2020 through 2025. After their presentation, I would ask that you vote to recommend that it be forwarded to the City Council for their review. The City Council will be reviewing this document in a work session on Monday, January 14th, with a public hearing scheduled for Tuesday, February 19th. Final adoption of the CIP is scheduled for the City Council meeting on Monday, March 4th. Thank you, and I'll be available after the presentation for any questions that you may have. We will start now with the Section 1 Vehicles and Equipment section of the plan, so that you have a tab associated in your folders, and I'd ask you to turn to that to hear about our first project.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Fire Chief Stephen Achilles. Our first project on page 42. This program is the regular replacement schedule for the city's ambulances. The 2013 ambulance is scheduled for replacement in FY20. So you'll see $85,000 in FY20. And you see in the out years a continued replacement program for the ambulances. On page 43. This is an out-year project. This is the project continues the CIP rolling stock replacement program for large apparatus. This is for a new ladder truck, and that is scheduled in FY23. Another out-year project's on page 44. This continues our CIP rolling stock replacement program of large apparatus. This is a replacement of our 2006 fire engine, and that will be in FY24 at $650,000. On page 45, again, the program replaces a large apparatus. This is a out-year project to replace the 2007 Ferrari aerial tower truck, and that's slated at $1.2 million at this time in FY24. Page 46. Personal protective equipment replacement. This is the third year of our replacement program. This is the last of the third year. This project meets the NFPA standard replacing our firefighter structural ensemble every 10 years, and that will be $60,000 in FY20. A new project is an out project in FY21. This is the replacement and upgrade of our hydraulic rescue tools. What typically we understand is or people refer to as jaws of life, and that is $95,000 in FY21. This is a new project, and it's a high priority. This replaces the close to 40-year-old 30-kilowatt emergency generator at our central fire station on 170 Court Street. In 2018, early this year, we evaluated the station's demands, and the current one is aged and woefully underpowered and is not reliable. So we have identified $100,000 in FY20 for this replacement.
Okay, if there aren't any questions, we'll continue on to the buildings and infrastructure section of your book, starting with page 50.
All right, sorry for that. On page 50, fire and rescue training facility. This is an out-year project. These are identified funds in FY22 and 23. And the scope of this project is to identify for future consideration a fire and rescue training facility on the Department of Public Works property as part of that site's master plan. We're hoping to have a facility for training because it's becoming more and more challenging to get facilities or acquired structures to do that type of training in the city.
So for the police department, we have land acquisition of a new police department. Results of the space needs study conducted in fiscal year 14 determined the current facility no longer meets the needs of the police department. This is also would fund the purchase of land for new facility if we do not have a site that the city already owns. No funding, it'd be an out year if and when that decision is made. Last is the results of the space needs study. Project would fund the design and the construction of a new facility after a site and conceptual design are complete. There is out-year funding listed from fiscal year 21, which would obviously be spread out over a number of years.
Good evening. Steve Bartlett, Business Administrator for the School Department. I'm starting on page 53, which is our school facilities triannual appropriation for the larger projects such as roofs and windows and things. On page 54, we have given some detail on some of the out-year placeholders that we're looking for, primarily as identified on priorities now, high schools and district-wide, and then Sherburne, some work on Sherburne School. Page 55 is the elementary schools upgrade appropriation, and we're asking for $2 million in FY20 to circle around and start the second phase of New Franklin School. We've completed the major portion of the work on Little Harbor and Don Darrell, so now we're going circling around back to New Franklin, which was our first, very first project. And then there are a couple of placeholders and out years to try to clean up anything that we have a tendency to find once we open up old buildings.
Hi, I'm Abby Mills. I'm from the Finance Department. I'm speaking on the record storage facility on page 56. We currently have a permanent record storage facility in the City Hall basement. We're looking for $50,000 to continue the expansion of this facility. We store over 2,600 records within the permanent records room for various departments throughout the city. However, we still have more documents that need storage that are currently exposed to things such as mold and possibility of fire or flood. On page 57, this is the project that funds the preservation of our specific documents. I left some samples up there. Maybe later you guys can look at them. We have currently over 1,600 records that are damaged with mold and or red rot that need to be preserved by law. And they need to be sent away to be cleaned and rebound. And unfortunately, this is all very expensive and will cost about $1.5 million when the project is complete. We're asking for $100,000 for FY20 to keep the momentum moving on this project.
Juliet Walker, Planning Director. On page 58, the item is land acquisition. This is an ongoing project funding for the purchase of land for municipal purposes should land become available. Funding in this project is intended to be used in combination with other available funding.
Good evening, Peter Rice, Director of Public Works. On page 59, our first project is monies that go to the existing outdoor rec fields for improvements to our existing inventory of fields. This is different from the a project that we will speak to in a couple slides. The next slide on page 60 is looking at the consolidated indoor recreational study, and this is anticipated to be potentially co-located with the Doble Center once that's complete. We've been working closely with the rec department for this, and it's year 2022. On page 61, new outdoor recreational fields. This is for the second phase of the expansion of recreational fields behind the community campus and the DPW. This project's currently under design. But these monies would be identified to complete the project once we've gotten through the first phase. So this is for second phase. On page 62 is a project that identifies the what we call the former stump dump, which is the Greenland Road practice field, which we anticipate in an out year adding loam and grass to make a recreational area, which could be multiple uses in addition to smaller sports activities. On page 63 is monies for the continuation of the Pierce Island Master Plan. This is an ongoing program, and these monies get set aside to make improvements to the facilities on the island. On page 64, monies are identified for the citywide playground improvements. The city has about 23 playground parks. Of them, about half have structures. These monies are set aside to be able to upgrade these facilities. We started about 20 years ago with playground upgrades, and now those facilities are now to be rehabilitated and upgraded. On page 65 is citywide park improvements. As I said, we have 23 parks and playgrounds throughout the city, and these monies are set aside to do improvements at these parks and playgrounds.
Next item is on page 66, which is the Vaughn Worth Bridge Strategic Vision Development. In 2017, the City Council adopted a strategic vision for this, the area encompassing Vaughn Mall, Worth Lot, and Bridge Street Lot. So this is allocation of funding to implement that strategic vision over a period of years.
Okay, on page 67, we are requesting funding to implement the Prescott Park Master Plan, and this is a capital improvement program that will require several years of funding. The request for FY20 from the general fund is $125,000. We'll start design of that infrastructure base to implement the master plan this upcoming year.
On page 68, emergency response shelters monies are identified to add to our capabilities at the emergency shelters throughout the city. We're looking to work with the new Doble Center to make improvements there as well to add to our inventory of emergency spaces.
On page 69, you'll see the McIntyre Federal Office Building site redevelopment. This money is for planning and implementation of the McIntyre site. We expect to be before the City Council to formalize the redevelopment plan in January, but we expect that the program, because it's a public-private partnership, will require ongoing legal and accounting assistance as it's implemented in its initial years.
On page 70, we have a citywide tree replacement program. These monies are used to upgrade or replace trees that have been removed due to illness or damage. And this is an ongoing program that's been very successful. On page 71, our recycling and solid waste program is in a little bit of a flux due to changing markets relative to recycling. And this is pushed out a year into 2021. To hopefully get more definition on the future of the solid waste and recycling markets. This next item on page 72 is upgrades to our transfer facilities, waste transfer facilities. This will enable us the ability to adapt to changing markets and be able to consolidate our loads so that we can get better deals relative to transportation of our solid waste. And these monies are identified to upgrade and create the new transfer station. On page 73, monies are identified in an out year to upgrade the Leary Field bleachers. The city has six cemeteries and one burying ground, historic cemeteries. These monies are set aside to do upgrades at these cemeteries, to do headstone replacements or repairs, as well as embankment maintenance and things like that. The city has the next sheet here on page 75. The city has over 30 retaining walls throughout the city. These monies are identified biennially to be able to do upgrades and repairs to these walls. On page 76, the monies are set aside here for sound barriers in the residential areas along I-95. As you have successfully seen, that the city has adopted modifications to our ordinances to have effective noise ordinance, which was an enabling step for us to have access to federal monies. We look forward to being able to implement this in hopefully in the near future. The next slide at page 77 identifies monies triennially for our facilities throughout the city. We have a backlog of deferred maintenance on a lot of these facilities. This facility alone has a backlog. The city municipal complex has a backlog of over $10 million. And so these monies go towards addressing these deferred maintenance items. On page 78, we have citywide storm drainage improvements. The funding associated with these projects are split evenly between sewer and the general fund. This is half the funding identified for our annual investments into our stormwater systems. On page 79, monies are identified for upgrades to the Hanover parking facility. We anticipate in FY 2022 doing a major rehabilitation of that facility, and you see that reflected here in the number at that year. On page 80, identification of high rate or level 3 charging station for a downtown location has been shown in FY 22. And that's what these monies would go to.
Okay, before we move to the information technology section of the CIP, I'd like to give the chair the opportunity if there are any questions from the board.
So questions of the board to the panel? Ms. Moreau.
I just have one because I think it would be helpful for the public to hear from our fire chief that all of the equipment that we're putting in here is actually going to sustain the amount of development that our planning board has approved in recent years. So that's either already in development or soon to be in development, and probably in the next 6 years. So I think it would be helpful for the public to know that that's going to satisfy, that what we've got in here is a good plan based off of that increase in population.
Thank you, and that is correct. It's that we've developed our capital improvement plan to ensure that the readiness of our apparatus and our staff, appropriate resources throughout the three stations, meeting the demand of the increased calls and also the increased development. And we're appreciative of the fact that we have such a positive response from the subcommittee on the planning board on this project. And I think as we move forward, we'll keep on monitoring when to move or adjust the plans, but they are best based on best practices.
Thank you.
Councilor Perkins.
Yeah, I had a question for the Director of Public Works on project on page 72, the recycling center. Can you guys hear me? It's two. So there's about $250,000 in this year's budget. Is that just for design work or?
That's for design work, correct.
Okay, and so I'm assuming somehow this ties into all the questions we have about how we're going to handle recycling going forward. Is the rationale kind of to bring it in-house or?
So the rationale at this point is not to necessarily bring it in-house in terms of like source doing separation and baling and things like that. This provides us the flexibility to be able to do something like that. The main driver at this point is safety. The current system is not a really safe configuration for moving people in and out. And the second, probably larger driver is our ability to consolidate the loads. Currently, we send packers up with roughly 13 tons or 13 yards of material. By having a transfer station, we're able to consolidate multiple loads into a 100-yard trailer and thereby save. It gives us options in terms of where we can send the material. Right now, we're kind of driven to go to the turnkey landfill because of distance. Mm-hmm. But there are other alternatives when we can get into a larger vehicle, and all we're paying is, you know, a single truck fee versus multiple. And then we save also on the wear and tear on our packers instead of going up back and forth up to turnkey. So there's a number of efficiencies that we're looking at. And it given the market the way it is, the recycling market is upside down in terms of the value you get for the recycled materials. It costs about $82 a ton for us to dispose of our recycled materials. Mm-hmm. It costs $63 a ton to get rid of our solid waste. So currently, we're spending a significant amount more to recycle than to dispose of our solid waste. We're hoping that this will allow us some opportunities to manage the market a little bit better. So that's, you know, kind of the impetus for this safety, but also give us flexibility operationally and adjust to markets.
Thank you.
Other questions for the panel?
Just one, and it's probably a misunderstanding on my part, but we're allocating more space for archiving of records, I understood, as a result of legal requirements. But how much of the records are we moving to electronic? So I'm a little confused on how much we need to keep from a paper versus electronic sources?
I can answer that. Actually, we can probably get you a more detailed answer from the city clerk. There's certain state statutes that require us to keep hard copy, but we are doing conversions to wherever we can to electronics. So what you see is a combination of historic documents that we want to maintain for the city, but also there's a myriad of state statutes that requires us to keep payroll records for a certain period of time. And in a lot of instances, the legislation hasn't caught up with technology. So we're working on that through, you know, trying to get the legislature to make some of those changes. But in addition, we are doing some of the electronics, and the city clerk's office is doing that as well.
All right, that's all. I figured, so the answer is we're doing as much as we can, but we still need more space for the...
And the thing...
Records are also being PDF so that they are electronic at the same time.
Oh, sure.
They're both.
Okay, I got you.
But there are statutes that require us. Plus, the historic nature, some of our records go back to, I don't know, 17...
We have early 1600 records, but most of them are 1700 and later.
Yeah, and we want to capture those before they got totally destroyed.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how they've been restored. And I want to just commend Abby. She got a couple grants for us. Nice. And so she did a nice job with Moose Plate Grant.
Yeah, Moose Plate Grant. We got just under 10 grand this year and last year.
Good.
So. Other questions for the panel?
Thank you.
Okay, keep going. I'm happy to move to the information technology section of the capital improvement program.
I'm sure.
Starting on page 82. As you are likely aware, information technology is a department that spans all departments within the city. There are 19 locations that are served by various pieces of the technology infrastructure. And pages 83 through 87, you'll see an inventory of essentially all of our machines behind the information technology. We run a regular program of replacing all of the city's computers, laptops, projectors, servers, printers, plotters on a regular basis to maintain their efficiency and make sure that they're operating correctly. You'll see in FY20 in particular, we have a move toward an office, Microsoft Office upgrade, and the fire department, school department all have their own items in FY20 for replacement. So these pages essentially are an ongoing program to keep our information technology fresh. On page 88, you'll see a new project identified in IT, which we're calling Continuity of Operations Redundant Site Buildout. This past year, led by the fire chief, we went through a continuity of operations planning process to identify how the city would continue operations in the event of a major catastrophe, where, in particular with IT, how the city would operate from an IT perspective should City Hall server room be closed down and the connection here go offline. So the project requested here is essentially to build out an alternative site to the City Hall mainframe, you know, IT room at a different location such that we'd be able to continue operations. So it's pursuant to a plan that was completed this year, and we'll look forward to carrying that out. On page 89, we have another project. As we go about upgrading our IT technology, we'd like to essentially downsize the maintenance and care of our systems by virtualizing our servers on a fewer number of machines. So right now we have 23 plus servers throughout the city, and we'd like to essentially shrink the size and run virtual servers on fewer machines that will certainly result in efficiency in terms of maintenance and lower energy expenditures.
You see on page 90, this is the second year of a two-year project for the fire department to get a web-based incident management reporting system on the fire side. I will say that we are looking at different options in conjunction with both the state and the police department's projects to see if this project will continue.
Chief Myrna, if you look on page 91, this is the upgrade to our CAD RMS system, our computer-aided dispatch record management system. Our system now that we're using, the IMT Tritech, is over 15 years old. It is a system that every time we have to add something to it, it's a $5,000 to $10,000 cost. It's a system that's been Frankensteined over the years, continued on adding nuts and bolts and pieces to it. And so we're in fiscal year 20. We've got money for, to start the project. It's roughly a $500,000 project, the outlying years would be the other 4 years. This is the entire dispatch system, which does the police, fire department, and 24-hour public works emergency.
You might add, Chief, that the first round of this was done through a federal grant, so so the first time, I think we got about $1 million for that.
We're in the demo mode right now, looking at some systems. One of the biggest thing that's happened to police departments across the country is that many of these systems are like that. They're a canned system where every time you need to adjust or add that they're, you know, they're costly. All of these systems now are set up so that that's not a function that is going to happen any longer, where you can build it into the system, but if you need to make changes, add categories, this will also allow us our management dashboards, our crime analysis, all of that come right up. Reporting for various department heads, police commission, city council, and things like that will all be generated from these various systems.
So next is our transportation management section of the CIP.
On page 94, you see monies identified for our shared lot agreements with private entities. We have a number of parking lots that we have agreements with private entities, so we can use those for folks to be able to utilize. They include the Masonic lot, the Connect Community Church, and the Baptist Church. On page 95, we identify monies for parking lot maintenance. The city has a number of parking lots, surface parking lots that require maintenance, and these monies are used for that. On page 96, monies are identified for parking meter replacements. These are significant investments in equipment, and we accumulate monies over a number of years and then do replacements once we have enough in place.
Next item is the Hampton Branch Rail Trail, which is the off-road portion of New Hampshire Seacoast Greenway, which is a shared bicycle and pedestrian route stretching from basically the border of New Hampshire all the way up to Maine. We have allocated money in previous years. We're waiting for New Hampshire DOT to negotiate acquisition of the abandoned rail from Pan Am, and we anticipate that that acquisition is closer than we ever imagined. And you can quote me on that. And so this is money actually to go into additional construction. The state will actually allocate money to do the initial design and construction to a stone dust path. So this is additional money should we decide we want to pave this portion and do any other amenities along this route. Next item is implementation funds for implementation of the bicycle and pedestrian plan that was adopted in 2014 and was updated this year. This is to be used in conjunction with other project funds and to give us the ability to be responsive to opportunities as they present themselves. We have shifted money from this money was previously funded from the general fund, but we shifted it to the parking revenues fund to be used as an alternative transportation, which is directly related to parking revenues. The next item on page 99 is implementation of the wayfinding system, which is primarily our signs around town. It also includes online electronic component, which we have yet to implement. But the next phase would be the pedestrian-oriented signage in and around the downtown. But that's for an out year in fiscal year 21. This is also being funded through parking revenues. The next project is on page 100, which is the North Mill Pond multi-use path. We just kicked off a design meeting last night, and that's using existing funding from previous CIPs. So this next round would be for any work around implementation, any legal work related to acquisition of easements, and then out years for bonding for the actual construction of the trail. Next item on page 101 is not a funded project. It's just for implementation of the Hodgkin Brook restoration and restoration plan, should we have opportunities to do that.
Next item is page 102. On page 102 is another item that was identified in our bicycle and pedestrian plan for construction of a multi-use pedestrian and bicycle path along Route 1. We would do this in conjunction with New Hampshire DOT, who actually owns that portion of the highway. And we would do it also in collaboration with private property owners. So this is money to help us with design and construction where needed. The next item on page 103 is related to that project, and I should mention that New Hampshire DOT has an existing project that we are anticipating they will complete design on that includes some road widening in these sections, so we would be doing this in collaboration with that project. The next item on page 104 is the Maplewood Ave Downtown Complete Street. This is in the midway of funding for this project, which is going through some design work at this time, and the outcome of that will be preliminary engineering plans. We also have some state funding allocated to this in the state's 10-year plan, and we anticipate that funding becoming available to the city in fiscal year 25. However, having the design plan complete sooner than that, we can also work with our private developers along this corridor to implement it in phases.
Page 105, monies are identified to perform an upgrade to the Market Square. This would include streetscape as well as utilities. We anticipate doing this in conjunction with the Fleet Street project, which has utilities that are interconnected to that area. On page 106, we identify Sagamore Avenue sidewalk. This is from Odeon Point Road up to the Wentworth Road, roughly near the Golden Egg. This would allow for pedestrian access along that section to an existing section of sidewalk near the bridge.
The next project is on page 107. This is a project that was identified in the Safe Routes to School Action Plan and then following that in the Bicycle and Pedestrian Plan to look at putting in sidewalks in the Elwin Park neighborhood, primarily focusing on areas to get school children to and from the Dondero School. We have some previous year funding for about $20,000 to do a feasibility analysis. So this money is an out year should that feasibility analysis determine that we do actually want to move forward with this project. We've also applied for state funding, which we'll hear about in a few months. The next item is on page 108, which is we did receive state funding through this congestion mitigation and air quality funding for the federal government. That's on page 108. It's the Elwin Road sidewalk extension and side path. This would be on the north side of Elwin Road, along where the Urban Forestry Center is located, and it would be a separated side path for bicycle and pedestrian use.
On page 109, we have monies identified for pedestrian accommodations along Banfield Road. It would be anticipated that the sidewalk would go from Ocean Road down to the new rail to trail that Juliet indicated will be coming sooner than we can expect. On page 110, citywide sidewalk reconstruction program. The city has over 77 miles of sidewalk. We conduct a sidewalk condition evaluation by walking the sidewalks and identifying areas and prioritizing. On page 111, shows a list of priority projects. They are not necessarily in a specific order, and they really are more of a backlog, and they will be completed based on synergy of other projects, road projects, water sewer types of projects, and we try to leverage funds from different areas to be able to accomplish these. But this is the list of priority projects we'll look forward to take care of. The city has about 20 signalized intersections, and the monies identified here are to upgrade these areas throughout the city. In addition to the signals, biennially we identify monies for intersection improvements, so leveraging the two monies we are able to do upgrades. The most recent example of that is the Andrew Jarvis intersection near the high school, which we accumulated monies over a number of years and were able to complete those projects. And we also completed Woodbury Avenue signalization project, which has come to completion just recently. This item is for the design for the Russell Market intersection upgrade. We anticipate installing a roundabout in this location, and the monies are identified in an out year. We currently have monies for to start the design. On page 115, the Pierce Island Bridge has been identified as needing replacement. It's on the state bridge replacement list, and it's identified out in 2025. The city recently completed a citywide master plan for our bridges. It identified a number of bridges that we need to be addressing in addition to the Pierce Island Bridge, Kearsarge Way Bridge, and the Market Street Bridge. There's actually two bridges on Market Street down near the Port Authority, and those three bridges were identified as priorities to address. And these monies identified here in FY20 are to take care of those three bridges. On page 117, the Maplewood Avenue bridge replacement was identified as a priority in the master plan. The monies identified for this first year are to start the design process. There's a significant amount of permitting associated with this. There's also about a $1.2 million of water and $1.2 million of sewer identified in this project. So this is a very significant project, and it's going to be quite an undertaking to address this.
Sure. This is not a funded item. It's the Kate Street Bridge replacement on page 118. This, as I'll talk about in a couple of slides, is related to what the Kate Street Connector project and would be either a replacement of this bridge or actually a discontinuing of this bridge, depending on how we go with the other projects.
Oops, I don't have that one. The next phases of the Islington Street project. The first phase is going to be going out to bid in the near future. Originally, we anticipated doing the entire project as from the bypass down to Congress Street as one project. Due to increases in costs and scope of work, it was broken up into two phases. Unfortunately, the prices are coming in really high, so we have to break the first phase into a phase 1A and 1B. So the monies identified here in 2021 would be for the second portion of the first phase, and then the out year in 2024, 25 would be for the completion from Dover Street down to Congress. These monies on sheet 120 are identified for transportation plans and studies that arise through our traffic parking, traffic and safety committee, and it gives us the flexibility to be able to address these things as they arise.
The next project is on page 121, which is the Kate Street Connector project that I alluded to previously, which is to look at extending Kate Street in across the current Frank Jones Center property and connecting to the Route 1 bypass. The proposal would be to do this in conjunction with private developers. This project has been in and out of the CIP since at least fiscal year 05 and probably before that.
On page 122, the Pebbly Hill Road project, which has been a long-awaited project, is in design. We have significant state and federal involvement with this, which is really very fortunate. Originally, we didn't have that kind of monies identified. So this year's monies identified are just state and federal monies. The local match is already adequate at this time. So we're happy that is the case.
And the next item, which I'm realizing we should just put these all back to back, is also related to the Connector Road project. There was a plan done by DOT related to improvements on Route 1, and as it happens, it would also be important to look at these improvements in relation to the Connector Road project, specifically looking to improve the signalization and potentially closing off the access from Cottage Street in order to better facilitate traffic flow through this area.
This next item on page 124 is the Fleet Street Utilities Upgrade and Streetscapes Project. I mentioned that the Market Square would tie into this as well. This is primarily a water and sewer and drain project. These monies are identified really to take care of the streetscape aspects that would not be paid for through the water and sewer and stormwater divisions. The next item on 25 and 26 are biennial monies associated with the street management program, similar to the sidewalks. We do a pavement condition index evaluation. We grade our roadways and determine what kind of investments we need so that we don't see a continually declining quality of roadway. The monies are identified here to continue our pavement management program. And similar to the sidewalks, we identify a list of priority roads. The Pease International Trade Port roadway system is something that we have a municipal agreement with PDA to address. These monies identified biennially are similar to what we use for our street management program, our pavement management program, but for the Pease area. And again, the list of priority streets. On page 129, the Junkins Avenue project is identified to do upgrades along Junkins Avenue, including the culverts along the causeway. This item was brought forward by a resident request. It's to do drainage improvements along Pinehurst Road. And this project on page 131 was a resident request to improve, to add curbing along Madison to better define the roadway width. It'll require some adjustment of the road width to be able to provide parking on both sides.
And that concludes the transportation management section of the CIP. Are there any questions from the board?
Questions for the panel. Councilor Perkins.
Okay. Everyone else is ready. I have a few.
Ms. Moreau, are you ready?
I just have a really quick question for Peter Rice. When we're talking about the Maplewood Ave Bridge project, I know it's way off in the future, but in all the studies that we've gotten about sea level rise and all of the issues that we're going to have in the future, I hope we're planning this project that it will actually be able to have fail-safes for, you know, flooding of North Mill Pond.
Yes, that all of the projects we do have a resiliency component to them now. Okay. And we work closely with Peter Britz in our planning department, who recently completed a resiliency evaluation. But that's, I mean, your point is really well taken, and it's something that we have to be aware of. You know, what happens when it floods? What are the, you know, and how does the bridge respond to that? So
great, thanks.
Yep.
Now, Councilor Perkins.
So on page 97, the rail trail. Mm-hmm. I know it will be here sooner than anyone can imagine.
It's never going to live that one down.
But,
it's okay.
Is this, I mean, I remember some meeting where we were kind of the missing link, and allocating funds for the purchase of this last piece was something we needed to do. So is this soon enough? Or
it is, yes. Yeah. The state, the state has, that was probably when we didn't really know what the state was going to do about their funding. Mm-hmm. They have CMAQ money allocated to this project, and that money is to be used for acquisition as well as construction.
Oh, that's
so
great.
That there's a consistent service along the entire route. Mm-hmm. And then it's up to the communities to do maintenance. We'll enter into maintenance agreements. And then if we want to do any additional improvements that are consistent with the intention for the trail, and that would include potentially paving, then it is up to the community to do that. So this is anticipating that we would want to do those improvements. But if we do not do those right away, that's fine, because we'll still have a functional rail trail.
Okay. On page 100, that's the North Mill Pond path, and my apologies for missing the meeting last night, but are the amounts and years reflected here sort of an awareness that we don't exactly know what the plan will be yet?
It is, yes.
Okay.
And as I mentioned last night, the intention is to come up with a consistent design along the entire corridor, stretching all the way from Bartlett Street up to Market Street. However, we do have immediate, we can do the immediate construction of the park that was part of the AC Hotel approval. We have that land. So once the design is done for the entire corridor, we will carry that forward to final design and implementation of that. And we have the funding available for that already.
Okay. A couple more, no.
Sure.
On page 103, it talks about the Route 1 crosswalks and signals. So is the proposal to actually do that project about 4 years from now, or are these just design monies that are allocated?
Those are initial design monies, so fiscal year 21 would be design monies, and then the next 2 years would be actual construction costs. We are very dependent at this point on the state's time frame, and they've had a plan to do this road widening project for more than a decade.
Okay.
But we do know that they have actually been talking about doing the design, meaning that they've actually solicited consultants. So we are hoping that it's in the next 5 years. So we continue to kind of adjust these numbers based on what we believe is a more accurate time frame.
Okay, and my last one, and page 119, Islington Street improvements. Obviously, my neighborhood's been following these pretty closely, and originally they were going to be done in one phase, and now we're sort of up to three phases. So the last time I remember talking to the staff, we were thinking about doing the sort of more comprehensive, like sewer and water and underground work in 21 and 22, but that obviously doesn't seem to be the plan anymore. So I guess, can you talk in a little more detail, Peter, about how this is rolling out? Because I think originally we thought everything was going to be done by 22.
Peter, if I might, you may want to mention that because of the shifting in the time frame, we did a resurfacing.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about that. So that, because that was the we thought we would have to do that earlier.
Right.
But I mean, we would have the money earlier for the whole project, but.
Yeah, so the manager is correct. Because there was anticipated delay in that section of roadway was in rough shape, we pulled a shim on it or an overlay on it so that we would have a workable surface for the meantime until we got to the full-blown reconstruction. The order with which the project was being done, the first phase was the heavy utility project. So that's the section from the bypass to roughly Albany Street.
Okay.
The section from there up is less utility intensive.
Okay.
So that's why it was kind of the demarcation of that section. We had we've done a number of cost estimates on this project, and the project has significantly increased in cost over time, and the money's available. We don't have enough money's available to do the entire section of phase one immediately. There's additional waters and sewer monies in addition to this 640 and road. There's additional water and sewer monies identified, which Terry will speak to in a second, to complete that second portion of the first phase. But as the manager mentioned, you know, in the meantime, we're not neglecting the rest of the corridor. You know, we're going to continue to address it, and we won't let it languish. And you know, the Goodwin Park is something that we're going to be doing some improvements to. The monies that have been identified for park improvements will be spent there. So it's something we will continue to do upgrades. It just won't be the full depth rebuild.
Yeah, and obviously I think the resurfacing addressed some folks' concerns, but other ones are kind of watching the whole project, you know, so that's helpful. Thanks. Sure.
Good?
I'm good.
Thank you. Other questions for the panel?
Thank you. Last but not least, we have the Water and Sewer Enterprise Funds.
Evening, Terry Damaris, City Engineer, and just a reminder that the funding for Water and Sewer Enterprise comes from Water and Sewer Billing, not from taxes, so I just wanted to provide a reminder for that. The first item here under page 134 is the annual water line replacement. So the city has about 150 miles of water distribution piping. A fair amount of that piping is older and in need of replacement, so as programmatically as part of projects or prior to annual paving, we go out and replace the piping, and the funds here provide for the costs associated with that replacement. On page 135, we have well station improvements. The city has 8 active wells and well buildings, and this project here provides for costs associated with rehabilitation of those structures, as well as the mechanical equipment inside of the wells, and in particular for those that aren't funded elsewhere, which you'll see in another item later down. We have a separate item for wells up in Madbury. Next item is reservoir management on page 136. The city pulls their drinking water from our surface water from the Bellamy Reservoir, which is located in Madbury, and it provides for the drinking water in the city of Portsmouth after being pumped. And the funding identified here for fiscal year 20 is to make improvements to the aeration system up in the reservoir to help stabilize water quality in the summer months. Next item is on page 137, Madbury Wells. So the city has three existing wells and one well that's in development currently up adjacent to our Madbury Water Treatment Plant. And the costs here are for a project to rehab two of the existing wells and for further development and construction for the well that's well number five. Next item is a new groundwater source on page 138. So this project consists of, you know, construction, permitting, and connection of another groundwater source in town. Work on this item is ongoing, and once the funding provided here is for completely equipping that well once the final location is determined. Next item is a water transmission main replacement on page 139. So the city has a transmission line that runs underneath Little Bay from Dover to Newington. The pipelines that run under there are aged, and we're currently in the midst of a project to look at how to deal with their rehabilitation or replacement. And the funds here are providing for final design and construction for that, and they'll be further, these costs will be further revised based on the preliminary design report. Next item is Willard Avenue water mains on page 140. The city's looking at a sewer separation project on Willard Ave, a portion of which has already been, a portion of Willard Ave has already been, had sewer separation completed. As part of the sewer separation projects, we go in and replace all the utilities generally. And this portion, or the funding for this area, this portion is for replacement of the water mains in the area of the sewer separation project. Next item is Islington Street improvements phase one and two, or 1B rather, and two. As Peter discussed, we, as part of the adjustments to the bidding and construction of the Islington Street projects, we've identified costs here for the water main portions of that work. Next item is Maplewood Avenue area reconstruction. So the city bid and is in the midst of construction of a project on Maplewood Avenue. So that work is underway. When we originally bid that project, there was a number of streets, Cuts, Central, Leslie, Beechwood, and Ashland. They're also identified for work. They were bid as alternates, but we weren't, with the available money, able to execute that work at that time. What we're doing is putting that money under fiscal year 20 for future construction, because they are in need of of this work to be completed. Similarly, on page 143, we have the Pleasant Street water mains. So we also bid this project and began its construction in 2018. There's a number of side streets off of Pleasant Street that are in need of utility improvements. And the costs here, again, similar to Maplewood, would provide for construction of that portion of the work for the water components. The next item on page 144 is the Newington booster tank painting. So the city is currently doing construction of improvements to the Newington booster pump station, which is a building adjacent to this tank. After a recent inspection of the tank, we identified the need to paint the exterior. Painting the exterior for this tank, which a lot of tanks of this age will require some lead abatement, so we're identifying some monies in the out year once this, once the booster station is complete, to do the exterior painting of this tank. Next item is for the Maplewood Avenue bridge replacement on page 145. As Peter mentioned, there's utilities associated with this bridge replacement. So this here just identifies the costs associated with the water components, and we don't anticipate the DOT would share in that type of cost. Next item is the Fleet Street utilities upgrade and streetscape. This is also a project, as Peter mentioned, that builds off of some funding from the general fund as well. But the driver for this really is sewer separation along Fleet Street, and then improvements both along a portion of Congress and up to Market Square. So this is identifying costs associated with that work for the water side in the limits of the project. The next item on page 147 is a DPW complex improvements. As as was discussed earlier, we're looking at the planning associated with the recycling center. The DPW complex, we're also investigating, and that complex supports the operations for the both the water and sewer departments, so we've identified funds from both enterprise funds for supporting that work. The next set of items here is for the sewer enterprise fund. Beginning on page 149, we have the consent decree mitigation. So the city of Portsmouth is part of the Pearson treatment facility upgraded, entered into a consent decree. There were adjustments to the time frame associated with that consent decree, and as a result, we negotiated certain mitigation projects. One of those was to provide sewer on either side of the Sagamore Avenue Bridge. And this here is, these funds are identified to meet that regulatory requirement for providing sewer in that area. The next item on page 150 is a long-term control plan related projects. The city has an ongoing program called the long-term control plan. That is a requirement of the EPA because we have a combined collection system where we have stormwater sharing the same pipe with sewers. We identify programmatic funds here to address items associated with this plan annually, and you'll see in the out years that there's a larger cost for an update to that plan. On page 151, we have the annual sewer line replacement. So similar to the annual water line replacement, we do programmatic upgrades of our sewer lines. We have about 115 miles of pipe. Again, many of the pipelines are older than 100 years and will be in need of replacement, so we plan for funds associated with that. Next item is wastewater pumping station improvements. The city recently completed a wastewater pumping station master plan, so we're currently adjusting and will adjust to the recommendations of that plan as we move forward. But essentially, we have 20 pump stations. We look to perform improvements to them as needed during the course of, to maintain their lifespan. And this just identifies funds for that work. The next item is the Mechanic Street pumping station upgrade. So Mechanic Street pumping station is the city's largest wastewater pumping station. Pumps all the wastewater up to Pierce Island. We're planning for its replacement in the out years, fiscal 23-24, and this identifies the funds for that item. Next item is the Willard Avenue sewers, which is similar to the water side, as I mentioned. We're looking at a sewer separation project on a portion of Willard Avenue, and this item identifies the cost for the sewer work. Next item is on page 155, Islington Street improvements, phase one and two, similar to the water and the general fund. This is providing for the costs from the sewer enterprise fund for the sewer portions of that work. Next item on page 156 is the regional digester facility at Pease. This is a study that was from previous year's funds. There's gonna be a study conducted for looking at a regional anaerobic digester, which provides for a reduction in sludge, the amount of sludge that's disposed of at a landfill. The results of that study will inform whether this one is feasible and two, what the cost might be and how you'd go about conducting that type of project. It's likely that it'd be in a public-private partnership, and all that would be investigated as part of that preliminary design, which will go on and hopefully be completed in the early part of 2019. Next item is a citywide storm drainage improvements. There's a cost sharing that goes on between the enterprise fund and the general fund for stormwater improvements, and this here identifies the cost share for the from the sewer enterprise fund for citywide storm drain improvements. Next item is for on page 158 for Pleasant Street sewers. Again, this project was bid and a portion of it constructed in 2018, and this provides for sewer utility improvements on the side streets adjacent to Pleasant. Next item on page 159 is a Maplewood Avenue area reconstruction, and similar to what I mentioned on the water side, there's a number of side streets that have the need for sewer improvements, and we'd like to execute those with these funds identified in fiscal year 20. Next item on page 160 is the Maplewood Avenue bridge replacement. And similar to what I mentioned on the water side, there's a sewer component to this as well. There's an existing sewer that runs through that arch bridge that exists today. So as we look at a new bridge, we'll have to look at replacing that sewer in that area. Next item is the DPW complex improvements. So this is just identifying the costs for supporting the improvements at the DPW complex for sewer operations, sewer department operations. Next item on page 162 is a Fleet Street utilities upgrade. And this is, again, as part of the sewer separation project on Fleet Street, which is a requirement of our long-term control plan, identifying funds for sewer improvements for that project. And the last project here is the Woodbury Avenue sewer separation. So the city recently acquired some land near Rockingham Avenue, which will provide an opportunity for us to do some stormwater improvements and allow for sewer separation to occur on Woodbury Ave from Farm Lane to Rockingham Avenue. So we're identifying this out-year project. Thank you.
Any questions for Terry? Thanks, Terry. Thank you. Nancy, anything to add?
No, just that we would appreciate a vote for you to recommend this for the City Council to next review.
So I agree. So I'd ask for a motion to adopt the capital improvement plan as the board's recommended program of capital improvement projects for the City of Portsmouth.
I would like to make that motion.
You have a second?
Second.
We have a second discussion. So the only thing I would say, and I think I said this last year, if you could only look at one document to understand Portsmouth, I'd point you to the capital and improvement plan. And it really does show the complexity of this city. I mean, there's just a lot going on in a lot of different areas. It demonstrates the commitment by the city to invest in the future to the benefit of its residents, its workers, and its visitors. And I think it really highlights that it does that in a fiscally prudent way, in particular, ensuring that the debt service remains at a manageable percentage of the annual budget. So I really, I commend the staff for putting this together and to execute this plan. So congratulations.
One thing I would like to add, this is online now. And it can be very useful for people other than just looking at these projects. There are links that actually you can go to look at reports that back up all these projects. So I would encourage you, if you're interested, as the chairman said, to take a look at this. Yeah.
Thank you. So call a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The motion passes. Thanks again.
Thank you.
So item two, approval of minutes. If I give it a motion to approve the minutes from the November 15th meeting.
Second.
Any changes or revisions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The motion passes. Item three, determinations of completeness. Site plan review, the application of the City of Portsmouth, New Hampshire owner for a property located at 125 Cottage Street, requesting site plan approval. If I could have a motion to determine the application is complete.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion passes. Thank you. Item four, zoning amendments, public hearing, old business. Amendments to the ordinance of the City of Portsmouth, Chapter 10, zoning ordinance regulating accessory dwelling units and garbage cottages, including revisions to Article 8, Supplemental Use Standard Section 10.814, accessory dwelling units, and 10.815, garden cottages, and revisions to Article 15, definitions Section 10.1530, terms of general applicability. So this was continued from our November 15th meeting. Julia, you want to update us?
Sure. So there were a couple items at the last meeting after the public hearing at that time that came up, and so we decided, the planning board decided to postpone final vote on this. The items, you have a handout in front of you that is a redlined version of the amendments proposed, and forgive me while I figure out how to use this technology without Julian here. On page 5, the recent amendments were related to
how we allow for additions to an existing single-family dwelling that is compatible and in keeping with the idea that we don't want accessory dwelling units to be outsized or over or not be subordinate to the principal structure. So there was some discussion about that, and what we are proposing is a couple modifications. Item 10.814.452 would allow for an increase in building height, but only if the addition is an upward expansion to the existing structure. So it would basically be adding a floor onto the existing building. With obviously, that would still have to comply with the zoning height limits. So it would basically allow someone to increase the height to add the accessory dwelling unit, but not expand outward in any way. The second item was 10.814.453, and that was to clarify that any addition done for an accessory dwelling unit that increased the building footprint would not increase the height of that addition above the existing building. So that was our recommendation on that front. And then the other item is on page 7, which was related to the definition of trusts and the question about living trusts and other kinds of trusts. So after consultation with the legal department, we just removed living. So it's any trust. How does that work, Colby?
It works, except we forgot a section as well that says trusts again.
Okay, so we'll make that change.
Yeah, 10.8.321.
Yep, in the garden cottage section.
No, well, we changed the garden, so the one before ADU generally.
Okay.
Other than that, it looks
good.
So
we can make that same correction generally in the ordinance. Those are the two changes since the last time we consulted.
Other questions for Juliet?
I think what you did with the height works.
Okay. Good. I think that was your concern at the last meeting.
I just wanted people to be able to go up if they had a half story or whatever within zoning. But this works, yeah, for me anyway.
So if there's no other questions for Juliet, I'll open it up for public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against these proposed amendment changes to the ordinance, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to recommend the approval of the proposed amendments to the City Council with the just addition of 10.814.321, making it consistent with deleting the word living.
Second.
Discussion? I'd just like to compliment the board. I think we've gone through this now for three meetings. The staff gave us a good proposal, and I think you all made it better, so thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any other comments? I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. Well, I know, but I'm gonna need you up here to give background for this next one, so I'll wait. So item 5, zoning amendments, public hearings, new business. Item A, the request of residents of Pinehurst Road to amend the zoning for the properties on Pinehurst Road from general residence A to single residence B. Ms. Walker, you want to give us some background on this?
Sure. So in October, residents of Pinehurst Lane, as well as Lookout Lane, submitted a letter to the City Council requesting that properties on Pinehurst Road be rezoned from general residence A to single residence B. The City Council, per our process, referred this request to the Planning Board. And this is one of the legislative functions of the Planning Board, is to consider requests from citizen petitions. And we do have to have a public hearing as part of that process. Your packet includes a letter from the petitioners as well as the petition. And then in the staff memo, we provided a comparison of the primary impacts changing from GRA to single residence B would present. The impacts are to, in the dimensional standards, are to lot area, minimum requirements. In a single residence B, the minimum lot area doubles.
from the existing GRA. The lot area per dwelling unit also doubles, to 15,000 square feet. Continuous street frontage requirement is the same. Lot depth increases to 100 feet from 70 feet. Front yard minimum increases from 15 feet to 30 feet. The side yard minimum, there's no change. The rear yard minimum increases from 20 feet to 30 feet. The building height maximum, there's no change. Building coverage decreases from 25% down to 20% maximum. And open space coverage increases from 30% minimum to 40% minimum. And then there's also a chart in here on the primary changes in the land uses allowed. Both of these are primarily residential districts, In the general residence district, two-family residences are allowed by right if the lot area minimums are met. In the single residence B district, which is the proposed new zoning, this is not allowed. Neither is a townhouse, a 3-to-4 family dwelling, or a bed and breakfast one, all of which are allowed in the general residence A districts by special exception from the Zoning Board of Adjustment. Again, they would all have to meet the conditions of dimensional requirements and so forth. But those are the primary changes related to land uses. We did do an initial analysis to determine how the existing properties would be impacted, and we're using property data from the city assessor record, so it's an estimate. We don't have survey data necessarily for all of these properties. But under the proposed zoning, the approximately 21 properties on Pinehurst Road, and we also included Lookout Lane, as well as the property fronting on South Street, which is also zoned General Residence A. Of those 21 properties, 13 would not meet the minimum lot area requirement under the proposed zoning. 8 would not comply with the minimum lot depth under the proposed zoning, and 4 would exceed the maximum building coverage under the proposed zoning. Whereas under the current zoning, all but one lot meets the minimum lot area requirement, and all meet the minimum lot depth and building coverage requirements. What this means basically is by rezoning this from general residence A to single residence B, it does impact these properties by making them non-conforming. They would be grandfathered, and they would be existing non-conforming situations, but if they ever were wanting to do an addition on their house, it would likely require a variance from the Zoning Board of Adjustment. So that's just something for more than half the properties on that road, that would be the result. So that's just something we thought would be worth considering when the board's weighing this input. In terms of the types of land uses, under current zoning, 8 of the properties have sufficient lot area to be converted to a two-family use. So they have sufficient lot area that is allowed by right. 3 have sufficient lot area for a three-family use, and only 1 could be a four-family. All of anything over three or more units would have to come to the planning board for site plan review, as you know. We do have a special provision of the ordinance, section 10.812, that allows for an existing single-family in the general residence district to be converted if it was constructed prior to January 1st, 1980. It can be converted to a multifamily use with less than the minimum lot area normally required in the district, but no exterior changes can be made, and they have to meet building coverage, open space, and parking requirements. So under this provision, more of the properties would be able to be converted to two-family uses. The same amount number could be converted to two-family, 15 to three-family, and 12 to four-family. But again, we don't see this used very often in Portsmouth, even though it sounds maybe a little bit scary to some people. It's very rare that someone would be able to convert their property without doing exterior changes. But that's just something else to consider. So under the proposed zoning, this wouldn't even be allowed at all. The multifamily uses would not be permitted. As to accessory dwelling units, under both the current and proposed zoning, accessory dwelling units and garden cottage would be permitted on all of these properties. So, as our memo explains, this is a neighborhood that is similar in character to the neighborhoods to the north and east that are also zoned general residence A. They typically are more densely historic neighborhoods, and the dimensional regulations do tend to try to reflect basically what the historic development pattern is in these areas. However, the distinguishing characteristic of this particular road is that it is a dead-end street.
Petitioners have expressed concern about the potential detrimental impacts from additional dwelling units on their street, and primarily due to concerns about increased traffic. Our suggestion is, if the planning board would like to consider recommending this to the city council as presented by the petitioners, that we would clarify that the properties being rezoned are all of the ones that are in this neighborhood that are general residence A. Otherwise, you'd have sort of these island properties. And so, therefore, and they were not all on the petition, so we would recommend that if the planning board decides they want to move this forward to city council, that we re-advertise clarifying what properties are going to be rezoned from general residence A to single residence B, and re-notice all of the property owners so they have that understanding. So that would be our recommendation.
So questions to the planning
board? I don't know if there's anyone from the petitioners who would like to speak as well. They didn't contact me whether they would like to speak, but that...
Well, they will have a chance in public hearing.
Okay.
And if you have a representative that you would like to speak now before the public hearing, I guess we can entertain that.
So is he speaking for the neighbor?
Apparently, yeah.
Good evening, members of the planning board. My name is Everett Eaton, and I reside at 155 Pinehurst. I think we've identified pretty well, you know, the reasons, and as Juliet mentioned, you know, it's a dead-end street. I think it's also, you know, worthy noting, right, that, you know, Pinehurst is also a narrow street. Cars park on either side out front of their houses, and people walk in the street, people bicycle in the street, kids play in the street. So the concern we have, you know, is to elaborate a little bit, is traffic and safety there. And in addition, if you're familiar with Pinehurst, is the line of sight as you exit and enter Pinehurst is particularly poor. If you're on Pinehurst, you can't see the traffic coming from the upper side of South Street, effectively from the Edgewood Manor side. You can't see it very well. So if you add volume, if you add additional housing units to the street, we're just going to impact an already kind of tight and precarious situation. So that's really behind our concern. We talk about, again, being narrow. And again, all the homes on the street at this point are all single families. So, you know, and the folks on the street have all signed the petition and are all supportive of it. Of the change in the zoning. So that's principally behind. If you have any questions, happy to take
questions
to the extent that
Council Perkins.
I can.
Yeah, I have two questions. One is, was there some kind of proposal or a rumor of a proposal that's prompting this, or how did this idea arise?
No, it, you know, really came out of, there was a home that was demolished in the summer, and the and a new home is being built on that site. And at that time, a lot of us then became aware of, well, what is allowed to be built on the street? And then it became, you know, really none of us were, you know, we've all lived there for 20 plus years, and we weren't really, you know, that aware of what could be built. But, and I think people became acutely aware of what could happen. And if you look at the street, and if you ever drove down it, you'd realize, wow, there's no cul-de-sac, and it's not a through street. And so the ability to handle additional traffic is really impeded just by, you know, the current design of the street and it being a dead end street.
Follow on?
Yeah. Well, slightly different question, but so I hear that. I think this is a tough request for us because what we're supposed to do is recommend zoning changes consistent with the master plan, which obviously strongly emphasizes allowing more housing density and more housing units. So I know you're all here and I know you all signed the petition and you all live there. So that obviously weighs very strongly on us too. But maybe you could talk a little bit about how you see those two things reconciling for us.
Right, sure. So it doesn't preclude accessory dwelling units, correct? Right? Mm-hmm. I'm clear about that, right? So accessory dwelling units could still be accomplished, and so we're not asking for that to be changed. It's just so that the change from single residence, from general residence A to single residence B, and that's, again, the difference between, you know, again, between Pinehurst and the neighboring community streets is that, you know, the dead-end nature, the narrowness again and no cul-de-sac. And also, like I said, the poor, you know, the particularly poor line of sight.
Ms. Burrow?
I guess my biggest concern would be, does every single neighbor in this neighborhood, and it goes partly to the re-notifying, do they understand which of them actually have houses that are going to be non-conforming? If they want to do anything with their house, they're going to have to go before planning, a zoning board,
right,
in order to be able to do something. And I just know that can be a burden on some people. So before any of this changes happen, I really want to know that everyone truly understands all the consequences.
Right, understood. And I guess I can't speak to everyone about that, right?
So I don't know, maybe that's partially for Juliet's question. How can we truly notify each person of you're going to be non-conforming? You know.
Yeah, we can certainly flag the properties that are potential for non-conformities, and we can include a letter that just basically explains what I said in my staff memo. But we could certainly call out which and identify the ones that would be a problem.
I just would hate for them to come back and be like, well, I didn't know that was going to happen. I just thought it was making the neighborhood better, because that's what some people,
right,
they don't dig deep enough. Lots of people do, but not everybody does. So that would be my concern.
Other questions for the applicant? Councilor Perkins.
Well, I just want to add a comment to that, which is, I mean, these folks are giving up a lot of rights on their own property by making the zoning change, and that's up to them to request. But in the same line, I mean, there's a large potential that their property could be worth less in terms of future value, you know, under the zoning change. So I just want you guys to make sure you're aware of that.
There's consequences to everything that's done.
Yes.
other questions? The only comment I'd say is that clearly none of your people, residents right now, will ever think about building a multi-unit place there.
Right.
So your concern is the future.
Yeah, that's right. So there's you know, the neighborhood is
right?
Older.
I mean, the reality is, you've all sort of said there's no way any of us are going to build a multi-unit,
right,
property. So the risk is, Everett, that you sell your property and
right,
the person who buys it does something. But, you know, the downside to Councilor Perkins' point is you go to sell your property in a non-conforming land now, and it's worth less than it was before.
Right.
And so,
right, potentially, right.
Other questions? All right, thanks, Everett.
Yeah.
I'll open it up now to a public hearing, and you're welcome to come back and speak at the
okay,
public hearing. Thank you. I appreciate you representing the neighborhood. So, any other questions for Juliet before we open up the public hearing? So, anyone wishing to speak to, for, against this proposed zoning change, please come to the podium. You want to time us?
Sure.
And you'll have 3 minutes, first round.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, board members, good evening. My name is David Underhill, and we live at 115 Pinehurst, so we are directly facing that just demolished construction project that was referred to. To not be redundant, I agree with what Everett said. I just want to add one or two tiny points. The first one is another thing that brought this to my attention, beyond the fact that we had that whole demolition hearing discussion about the property across from us, is the fact that the property at 482 Broad Street is across my fence. So we are looking into a 3-townhouse unit now, which didn't exist 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been through it. I mean, we are living with that exact change occurring out our backyard on Broad Street. I think that made us particularly aware and concerned when we started to hear and see the change that could occur on our own street. The second thing I'd like to point out is that we're very, very fortunate. By the way, we love this street, and I think you've gotten that message from the petition. We're very, very fortunate that we're not really asking to change the reality that is Pinehurst Road. We do not have multiple family dwellings on the street at this time. So I'm not good at the code acronyms, the GRA that permits those things has not in fact kicked in. And so our reality is we're SRBs with various coverage and you know, offset differences perhaps. We would love to keep it that way. So on top of all of the traffic concerns, I would just like to emphasize this isn't an arbitrary worry on our part.
I've seen it happen on my lot line, and we had further suggestion that it could happen in the future with this last development project. We know things will change. We know there is pressure to build new properties, and I hope you'll consider this carefully. We're very pleased with our neighborhood. I'm not aware of a neighbor who disagrees with this request. I haven't combed the signatures to know that every single one signed, but a preponderance of us did. 10 of us came out tonight. We'll come out in the future and discuss it further. I'd be delighted to answer questions, but I thank you for considering this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are the first time speakers?
Michael Magnet, 140 Pinehurst Road. Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board, thank you for your time. I know your time is very valuable. I won't repeat what my fellow neighbors said. I will just ask that you consider this, and hopefully you will vote in favor of it and move it on to the City Council. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are the first time speakers?
Sally Mulhern, 60 Pinehurst Road. I'm right at the intersection of Pinehurst and Lookout Lane. Thank you all very much for your time. The one factual point that I'd like to make is not only is Pinehurst Road a dead end, but Lookout Lane is as well. So we have 2 points where we have no outer egress. And I second everything that people before me said, particularly regarding access onto Pinehurst and the difficult views. Thank you.
Thank you. Are the first time speakers? Second time speakers? Third time? Thanks for your comments. I'll close the public hearing. I'd like discussion, if we could, before we entertain a motion, because I'm not sure exactly where this is going to, which direction this will go. And so I'd like to get a sense for your thoughts, concerns, comments. Beth, you want to kick it off?
Sure. I've dealt with this property quite a lot in the last few months due to the demolition of the property that was on that house. So I have driven down the street and actually taken a look at the whole neighborhood and sort of understand where this request is coming from and the protection that I had to do a 3-point turn at the end of Pinehurst Road in order to turn around. So that is truly a problematic place to be. And I could understand a lot more people living there would definitely, you'd have to do some changes to the road. You'd have to increase it. You'd have to probably have, and that you're right on the verge of wetlands because all these properties are in wetland buffers too. So I think that's also something to keep in mind. If we allow expansion, we're doing it in a wetland buffer for part of this property. So while I understand that side of it and it's not a bad idea, I do get very concerned that, you know, my comments earlier, I would really like to see that the people who are going to be non-conforming are flagged and told that, you know, your property is now non-conforming, and kind of briefly what that means is that they should seek sort of to speak to someone at the planning department to get really details about what that means. Like, you can't do anything with your property without getting permission is kind of what I want them to be told. And if that happens and they're all still on board, then I guess I would feel less uneasy about moving this to a city council level. That's my thought. But I agree with the postponement until we have truly a good note.
Yeah. Yeah, just the way Juliet had phrased it, whether we want, if we're interested in moving it forward, then we'd renotice it. I think whatever the board's wish may be, it should be just renoticed and brought back in January. And once whether there's, everyone will get the notice and we just make it clear that, I don't know how we would do that necessarily, the gravity of the changes, but certainly a renoticing with all the properties, including the one on South Street and whatnot, and then take it up in January.
Okay. Other comments or feedback, Councilor Perkins?
Yeah, I think this one hurts a little bit just because, you know, like I said, it obviously we worked hard on a comprehensive master plan that encourages more housing units in our city. So a zoning change feels like a really strong protection given the reality on the ground here, which is that there's very little threat of change in this neighborhood, especially considering all the owners, you know, sort of like the way that it is now. So My concern is that zoning changes are hard to undo, and you know, essentially what this does is lock in a density that you know, doesn't open up another spot for a young family to come into our city. So I take the point that accessory dwelling units are allowed, but and I also take the point that all the residents on the road, you know, want this change, and they're here and they're involved in the process. So I'm struggling a little bit with it, but I'm interested to hear, you know, what happens next month.
Yeah, I mean, I agree we should get more information and continue the public hearing. Although, I'm with you, Rebecca, because clearly it's a terrific neighborhood. I mean, anyone who's been there, mm-hmm. just passing through, understands that. You all live there, and I get it, mm-hmm. and I get how special it is. But as a planning board, I have difficulty thinking that we're going to change the zoning in an area and all of a sudden the majority of the properties are non-conforming.
Yeah.
It, regardless of the master plan or anything else, that just fundamentally just seems so inconsistent, regardless of what the current residents may want.
Mm.
Because we need to think about both the current residents and the future.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a tricky one. I for you guys, I'm certain it's a no-brainer, and I do get that and appreciate it. But I think I would just ask you to understand the complexity that we face as a board, because it would be easy to just say, yeah, everyone wants it, let's do it. But I think the unintended consequences are not insignificant. So that's why I'd actually want more time to get more information to think
mm-hmm.
about it, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
Other comments or input at this point? So if not, then Colby, you want to give me a motion?
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we vote to continue the public hearing to the January 2019 Planning Board meeting with Juliet's re-noticing of the properties.
Second.
Discussion. The only thing I'd ask Julie is there any other analysis? You guys, I thought, did a pretty nice job in this.
Yeah, right. Really,
I thought it was a great analysis. If there's anything else that you can bring that will help this board understand and make a more informed decision, I'd ask you to do it.
Okay.
Anything else?
Well, I guess my other thing would be on that front. Would there be any other options besides SRB?
Mm.
Well, that's a good...
I don't know if there are.
Not really.
Okay.
If the intention is to really... I mean, single residence, there's only two single residence districts. And SRA would be a larger lot area. So
another GR? But GRA is really the most...
GRA is the most restrictive.
That's what I figured.
Restrictive.
Yeah. I just thought I'd put that out.
It's
there.
A good thought, and I did think about it, but unless we created a whole new zoning district.
No. That's not going to happen.
I would not recommend.
No. Any other comments? I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Thanks very much for your input, and we'll see you in January. Oh, okay, good. So, item B, the request of Attorney Rob Candela to amend the zoning for 290 Gosling Road. From waterfront industrial to office research. Who's here to speak for this applicant?
Chairman, members of the planning board, good evening. I'm Rob Chandela, Donahue, Tucker, and Chandela, and I'm here this evening with Patrick Crimmins of Tie and Bond. We appreciate you have a packed agenda, and we have a very brief presentation. To set up Patrick, who's going to show you the visuals on this, I just want to give you what we think is the basic framework for our request. The land we're seeking to have rezoned is presently zoned waterfront industrial. The city zoning ordinance states that waterfront industrial property is for uses which depend on direct access to the Piscataquis River. This property does not have direct access to the river. Between this property and the river is a rail corridor and another parcel. We are requesting that the property be rezoned from waterfront industrial to office research. The city zoning ordinance states that the purpose of office research property is to provide for campus-style development of office buildings. This property is adjacent to and contiguous with an existing campus-style office park, the Portsmouth Office Park. So once the property is rezoned, we plan to develop the property to become part of that office park. Right now, there's no access to the property, from the property to the river, from the river to the property, or even from the existing road network to the property. So we plan to integrate the property into Portsmouth Office Park and provide access through that park. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Patrick so he will provide you the visuals to about what I'm talking about.
Thank you, Rob. Patrick Kermans with Tie and Bond. So we had included some plans and visuals in your package, but I actually think probably the most telling graphic was the one that was included in the staff memo. It really kind of demonstrates the color overlay of the zoning on the aerial, depicting the OR district. You can see that the parcel itself, which is landlocked, it's 290 Gosling Road. It actually doesn't have a driveway that's right off of the road. It has an easement through 280 Gosling Road, which is currently owned by the power plant. As Rob mentioned, it doesn't have direct waterfront access. In fact, it's blocked by two parcels, both owned by the power plant and a railroad to the north. So if you're looking at that graphic, you know, the pink in the OR, you can see the Portsmouth Office Park surrounding it. It's pretty telling. And the parcel that's immediately, or I'd say south of that, was recently actually developed, approved by you folks, and constructed at 75 Portsmouth Boulevard. It's a 65,000 square foot office building. It was just completed this past year, is actually expected to be occupied this coming year. There's a strip of land along Portsmouth Boulevard that is part of that piece of land that actually runs up to the northerly property line of this parcel. So in conjunction, you know, the property owner of 290 is the same property owner of many of the buildings in that office park. And the intent would be to whether it's merge it with that parcel that's occupied by 75 Portsmouth Boulevard or in 215 Commerce Way, or subdivided, either way, is to create that frontage on Portsmouth Boulevard and then develop it as an office building that is consistent with that office park.
Questions for the applicant?
Mr. Chairman, I just got to recuse myself.
Okay. Ms. Murrow.
What is currently going on the property now? Is there anything going on?
Sure, that's a great question. So the parcel was previously industrial. It was owned by Sprague Energy. So thus the industrial, but and actually had some of the aerial graphics. This one is actually up to date, but you can see there was some old tanks on the site. They've actually since been torn down. So the parcel itself right now is vacant. It's not doing anything. It's just waiting basically for this rezoning and the opportunity to be developed as office.
I know that when we did that office building that just got built, there were some neighbors very concerned about the amount of traffic going to that building.
Mm-hmm.
I believe across the street directly from this lot, if it had road frontage from on Portsmouth Boulevard, is that the hotel?
That's correct.
Okay. Sometimes I get turned around. So yeah. So I'm assuming we won't have as many issues going down there other than maybe at that intersection. I mean, if that could still be a problem. I know that neighborhood gets a little sensitive to over being too much office park if it grew too big. So I guess my concerns as you look at this is maybe to put a feeler out to the neighborhood about this change as well. I know that they're probably put on notice, but do they truly understand once again what that might mean? So it might be beneficial for you guys to just put a feeler out to the adjoining lots and at least the neighborhood to let them know what the plan is.
Absolutely, that's a great comment, thank you.
Are there questions for the applicant? Thanks, Patrick.
Thank you.
We'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers, third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing.
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion that we vote to recommend that City Council rezone this property to waterfront industrial, from waterfront industrial to office research, with the caveat that I think that a proper notice to the neighborhood just to make sure they're aware of this change, so if they had something to say, they could make a public hearing at the City Council level would be appropriate. I think it makes sense to change this, but I'd like to make sure everyone is aware.
So I would just look to clarify that after we had a second.
Okay, do we have a second? Jody, second. So which?
Yeah, so if the, it would be the planning department's preference if the applicant would help us with that notification process, because we've already done our legal requirements in terms of notification. So if that, if you're agreeable to that?
No, I'm fine with that. I just.
Prior to first reading?
Yep. Okay. Yep. That, I just, you know that people are going to come out of the woodwork and say, I didn't know that was going on. Why wasn't I informed?
So we can work with the applicant on making sure that people are.
Sounds good to me.
So there's one stipulation with that, and everyone understands that? Any other comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Thanks, Beth. Thank you. Item 6, public hearings, old business. Items A, B, and C are all connected with the application of Peace Development Authority owner and Lonza Biologetics, Inc. applicant for property located at 70 and 80 Corporate Drive. They've asked for a postponement. If I have a motion to postpone this application.
So moved.
We have a motion, second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Item D, the application of Clipper Traders LLC owner for property located at 105 Bartlett Street, Portsmouth Lumber and Hardware LLC owner for property located at 105 Bartlett Street, and Boston and Maine Corporation owner for railroad property located between Bartlett Street and Maplewood Ave. This applicant has asked for a postponement. If I get a motion to postpone.
So moved.
I also recuse.
Ms. Monroe has recused herself in this one.
Second.
We have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? The motion passes. Item 7, public hearing, new business. Item A, the application of Carol B. McComb, Reverend, Revocable Trust of 1998. Carol B. McComb, trustee, owner, for property located at 910 Sagamore Ave, requesting conditional use permit approval under Section 10.1017 of the zoning ordinance for work within the tidal wetland buffer to install a replacement residential sewage disposal system and removal and remove the old system septic tank and pump chamber with 1,570 square feet of impact to the tidal wetland buffer. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 223 as Lot 26A and lies within the Waterfront Business District. Who's here to speak for this application?
I'm Susan Ferretra, Ferretra Septic Design, and I'm representing Carolyn B. McComb, a Revocable Trust of 1998. I have a change to the plan and an additional report from the Conservation Commission.
You can just give Jody, we'll pass them down. Just give the little pack to Jody and we'll pass them. Save you the effort to walk.
The situation on this property is the
Susan, if you could just use the handheld microphone if you're going to move over to the map, please.
Thank you.
So that we can hear you and the people at home can hear you.
This property is located off of Sagamore Avenue. It is part of Sagamore Avenue. It's the gravel road that goes down, cuts around behind the scuba shop, and ends up down at the creek. This is the corner lot. The entire parcel is within the 100-foot wetland buffer. There are wetlands across the street that go through a drain that comes out into Sagamore Creek. There's Sagamore Creek. There's also some poorly drained wetlands in the existing lawn and in part of the wooded area on the slope that goes down to the creek. So altogether, the entire lot is within 100 feet of a wetland. The existing home has been here since, I believe it was 1962-ish. No, I'm sorry, 79. And it's a 0.62 acre lot. The existing septic system consists of a septic tank and pump chamber that leads through a forest main up to an existing leach field. During some recent underground locations, it was found that part of the existing leach field is on an abutting property. Ms. McComb would like to correct this situation. So she had me design a new system for the property, which consists of an advanced treatment system. that will replace the existing septic tank that would lead to a pump chamber and the force main leading up to a new small leach field, stone and pipe, that is the state's required 75 feet from the surface water of Sagamore Creek. It is within the 100-foot tidal buffer, so a Wetlands Bureau application has been submitted to the state. The existing system will be removed in as far as the tanks will be removed. The force main will be abandoned, so there won't be any digging through. This is the wetland in the lawn area. This is the edge of the lawn. All this is grassed. And then the existing leach field will be abandoned, so that we're trying to minimize the effect of the disturbance within the 100-foot tidal buffer zone, as well as your 100-foot buffer zone that's coming from most directions. The existing system, as I said, will meet and surpass the septic, the state septic setback of 75 feet, whereas the existing one is between 60 and 65 feet from the creek currently. I presented this to the Conservation Commission and had the an area designated that's now lawn to go back to the natural vegetation, and they had suggested, rather than letting it just go and it could end up with some invasive species, to plant it. So that's what the new plan shows that, and I had the wetland scientist put that together for me, and so that report is the background for why he chose the plants that he did and this spacing. And it's also here in this green section right in here. We've put the new plantings, and there's the revegetation schedule right up here in this corner. Other than that, the plan remains the same as was submitted to originally to you. So the total, the area within the 100-foot buffer that's going to be impacted is 1,576 square feet, which sounds like a lot, but most of it is going to be only temporary, and that would be where the tanks are going, because they're below grade, and the force main is below grade, and the only permanent impact is right up in this area, because the new septic system is going to be at a higher elevation than the old one, and it's going to be a bit of a mound.
Questions for the applicant? Mr. Clark.
I guess I actually don't, I do have, my question, how is the force main going to cross that drain line?
The force main will go either under it or over it, depending on how deep that drain turns out to be.
Okay.
My understanding is the drain is about 6 or 7 feet below grade, but there is a clean out here. There's a cover, so you can see down in there. I haven't done much looking into it, but so it's going to have to get past it by going underneath or going over, whatever seems more appropriate.
Okay. The reason I bring that up is I've actually looked at this property for a previous tenant and looked inside that drain line, and I guess I'm totally for the new septic and everything. I know it's a very difficult site. There's a lot going on. And I guess my only comment would be is I would encourage the owner to really look into that whole drain system. It's a really, this is unrelated, but it seems to be made up of several different types of pipe and different ages of pipe. And it's something that benefits the entire neighborhood over there, but it seems like this one owner is kind of stuck with it. So, moving forward, possibly if this force main, not to, increase the amount of the project, but if things have to get torn up anyways, it might be the right time to look at this whole drainage thing and this whole drainage issue with this whole property, because it is kind of a difficult
property. There's a culvert over in this wetland that this is open water in here a lot of the time that drains a fair amount of area that comes through here. So it's off the property as well as through the property.
Right, and that's why
it affects.
Yeah, and that's why it's a drainage system that benefits, everybody, but it's owned by this property owner. So it's not like typically I would feel that this would be a municipal drain line and they'd have easements and yada, yada, yada. But in this case, that's not the case. So all I'm saying is, you know, if things are getting torn up anyways for this, it might be the right time, the owner, to just to look into the drain line. I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
It may not be the appropriate time to do it.
Right. Well, my concern would be is that because it's in the tidal buffer zone, it would have to be any work on this drain past this point here would have to be was permitted by the state as well, and would have needed to or wanted to go in to a Wetlands Bureau package.
Right.
I'm not familiar with how to deal with if because it affects other properties. I'm not quite sure personally how to deal with that. I think that would probably be an engineering company may be the right people to look into that. But yeah. I understand your concern, certainly.
Yeah, and I mean, as far as the wetland stuff go, I mean, it's my understanding, you know, you can get an amendment or something like that to the permit if the scope of work increases. But I'm just stating that, you know, when I took a look at it for a tenant, there were some concerns, that's all. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you. Other questions for the applicant? Thanks, Susan. I'll open it up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. Thank you. What's the wish of the board?
I have
it. Oh, yeah.
So the applicant provided the stipulation, so we can probably just remove that stipulation and say that the board can vote to grant the conditional use permit as presented at the meeting tonight.
Correct. Thank you. I was going to head in that direction as well. No.
Julie, you have a question?
Yeah.
So we just talked about how in a few short years we're going to be bringing sewer all the way down to either side of the bridge of Sagamore, right? That's not there. So I always feel like it's sad that we have to do this now, where possibly in 5 years they could actually connect to a sewer line.
Yeah.
Or is that my mistake that this property wouldn't be
Ray
part of that?
Ray can probably speak to this, but I think you can't hold out. You know, you never know what's going to happen. So I think, you know, certainly it would probably be better not to do septic, but if the septic is not suitable at this point, it's better to improve it.
And it's also on someone else's property. So I think they're trying to rectify the situation.
Yeah. Oh, come on, it's John Ritchie. He'd be nice about it.
So I agree with you, but sometimes timing doesn't work.
All right.
So if I get a motion to grant the wetland conditional use permit as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Mr. Chair, I think it's already been stated. It's definitely something that's necessary. It's a reduction. It's going to be a better system. It's a tough property to deal with, but it satisfies the factors.
I agree. Other comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item B, the application of Brick Art, Brick Act, LLC owner, and Kristen Fresha Treehouse School, applicant for property located at 102 State Street. Requesting conditional use permit approval pursuant to section 10.1112.52 of the zoning ordinance to expand a preschool from 20 students to 28 students where 14 parking spaces are required and zero off-street parking currently exists and no additional off-street parking is proposed. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 107 as Lot 52-1 and lies within the Character District 4, the Historic District. Who's here to speak for this application?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Tim Phoenix from Hopeful Phoenix, formerly in Roberts here in Portsmouth. I'm here tonight with and on behalf of Kristen Fischera, who's the owner-operator of the Treehouse School, which is a preschool for children ages 3 to 5. Prior to 2017, here tonight is Karen Buffard, who's the principal of Brick Act. Prior to 2017, Karen renovated this building. The bottom floor was commercial, and the upper floor was made into an apartment. At that time, the zoning board gave variances for those uses. I believe it was 4 spaces for the commercial use and 2 for the residential use. In April, I believe it was, of 2017, we came before the zoning board because at the time, the parking requirement required zoning board relief. It's been changed to a conditional use permit before this board. At the time, Kristen intended and has a school for 20 students. There are actually 25 registered kids, but only 20 are there at any one time. There are 2 spaces needed for every student, so half a space for every student, so 20 students needed 10 spaces. So the overall use before the zoning board in April of 2017 was we needed 12 total spaces, 10 for the preschool, 2 for the residential use. And the residential use had already been granted a variance, so we were granted the variance for 10 students. Kristen's business has been very successful. She's got a wait list out to 2022. She has all kinds of additional requests for placement of children in the preschool. So she'd like to expand it to 28 students. And the way she's going to do that is she will cease the residential use. And the upstairs will be converted. She's working with the building department now for what changes need to be made in order to accommodate egress and all those kinds of things. So to gain the extra 8 students, we now have to come before this board to obtain a conditional use permit. And I apologize to the board. As I was preparing this, I realized that I had not attached exhibits such as the tax map and some photographs that would sort of give you a visual of where it is. So I have those. I don't know if there's enough, but I think there's 10 copies there. So while those are being passed down, you can look at the tax map. This building is on the lower end of State Street as you approach the bridge. You can see it's a small lot. There is no parking on it. There never has been parking on it. There can't be parking on it. There's no place to put it. I would also mention that if this building was approximately one block up State Street or about a half a block up Chapel Street, it would be in the downtown overlay district and wouldn't require any parking. I didn't bring the downtown overlay district outline, but it sort of notches around this area. I'm not sure why, but it notched out this area. So the use of the property is that there are about 17 students who are local who, at least when the weather's good, they either walk or ride bicycles with their parents to school. There are 3 or 4 whose parents live out of town, but they work in Portsmouth, so they're already parking in Portsmouth, so they drop their kids off and go park. And then there are some Portsmouth residents that drop their kids off and work in Portsmouth, so they're already parking in Portsmouth. Then there are some that drop their kids off and go out of Portsmouth and work somewhere else. The overall effect is that there's no real change in effect on parking. These parents drop their kids off in a few moments, 2 to 5 minutes at the most. There is, as the attachments I gave you show, there's plenty of parking on State Street most of the time, particularly in the morning. There's the other lot next to the flags near the bridge. There's another lot down next to Prescott Park that usually has openings. Attached to our submission is our memos from 19 families saying that they have never had a problem in any way dropping off their kids with parking, where they parked, how they parked. And importantly, Kristen also obtained a memo from 10 nearby business owners. It's exhibit 3 to my submission. Pickwick's, Fezziwig's, Raleigh Wine Bar, Birch, Dos Amigos, Agave, Portsmouth Provisions, Googie's, Buff and File Nail Bar, Canine Cupboard, Redhead Studio. And they say, I agree that the Treehouse School of Portsmouth drop-off and pick-up schedules do not negatively affect my business or the availability of parking for my patrons or customers. There are 3 teachers at the school today, and the increase of 8 students, there will still be 3. So the effect on parking for the staff won't change from what it is today. I hope you'll agree that when we have the comments from parents, the beauty of today is that when we were here before the zoning board in 2017, it was all prospective. We didn't think that we'd be a problem, and we convinced the board, they agreed, but we didn't know. Now she's been open for about a year and a quarter, a year and a third, and we have actual empirical evidence of what happens on the street every day. Also attached to my submission is Exhibit 1, which is a chart by Kristen. That's where I got these numbers, 17 students walk or bike, 3, I think it's now 4, are parents from out of town who work in town or store parking. Average time is 2 to 5 minutes. And also the drop-off and pick-up is staggered. Some come earlier in the morning, some come in the middle of the morning, some leave at noon, some leave in the middle of the afternoon, some leave later in the afternoon. So it's not like you've got 20 cars full of kids coming all at one time. There are also several, how many, Kristen, sibling groups? Three sibling groups, so you've got two kids in one car, for instance. So we think that the actual evidence of what we've done here and provided to you with Kristen's chart, with the memos from the parents, and most importantly, the approval of a number, 10 local businesses who say we're not affected, supports the granting. Included in the submission is the required parking analysis. We did that by essentially this argument, plus Kristen's comments in or work in Exhibit 1, the Exhibit 2 from the neighbors, I mean from the parents, and Exhibit 3 from the nearby commercial neighbors. So in summary, it's an area where there is plenty of available parking most of the time. We only need parking for a very short time. It's not a permanent effect on Portsmouth any different than it is today, including the fact that there's only three employees, and there will be three employees for the 28 students. So when you balance the parking needs, and we all know there's parking needs in the city, against the effect on parking of this particular use, which has been embraced, I think we're the only game in town. We're the only, are we the only preschool that you're aware of in town? So we think we're the only game in town, and it's not like the other commercial uses. You know, we're not a coffee shop or a retail store or a restaurant or a bar where people come and park for an extended period of time, and you need more employees, you need more places for the people who are visiting to park. Here it's find a spot, walk them to the door, get in your car and leave. So we think we've met the requirements for a conditional use permit from this board and would ask you to approve it so that she can make her successful business a little bit more successful.
Questions for the applicant? Ms. Moreau.
So one of the things that we're supposed to look at is alternatives to parking. and I know you guys have already presented some, but I think it's, no one talks about the giant drop-off loading zone that's like right outside that building. I don't know, have you approached the city in any way about trying to find a legal way for the drop-offs of the kids to be used as well as a loading zone? I don't know if that's even possible. I don't know if anyone from the
city. We have not approached the city about that. It did come up at the zoning board, the fact that it's there. I mean, it's there. I've asked Kristen about it, and she says as often as not there is a truck there loading and unloading. So if parents drop their cars, stop there, I mean, we're not going to go out and say, you know, you can't do that, but it's worked, and the neighbors say it's worked. We've also, I don't know if I mentioned this, we also have one leased space at Strawberry Bank. So Kristen has been living in there, and so that parking space is used all the time. She is going to be moving out, so now one of the employees can park there. So that's one way, you know, we've bettered by one space in Portsmouth. And as I mentioned at the outset, the ask is really for two more, because we really need 12 where we are and have relief for all of it, and now we want to, now we need 14.
Other questions? Tim, is 28 students the maximum that this space can handle, or are there more?
Nope, yeah, so that's the maximum.
It's the maximum.
Yeah, upstairs is, it's 40 square feet per child.
For the record, this is...
Yeah, okay. Come up to the...
Yeah, actually, why don't you come up so that people at home can hear you, if you could introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Kristen, the owner of the Treehouse. So upstairs, it's 40 square feet per kid by the New Hampshire licensing. So upstairs is 8, and then downstairs is 20.
Okay, so you'd be at the maximum if you expand to 28.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions? Thank you. Tim, thanks. Open up to a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. State your name and address for the record, please.
Karen Bouffard, I'm the owner of 100 State Street. And I would just like to say that Kristen has been a wonderful tenant, very responsible. And I, for one, am very happy that she's using the property uniquely instead of, as Tim says, another coffee shop or bar or restaurant. So I hope you can approve this and she can expand as necessary. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Other first-time speakers?
Good evening, Patrick Kerman, 618 Dennett Street. It's just kind of coincidence that I'm here this evening while this application's on, but we have some good friends that actually send their children to the Treehouse, and they have told us what a wonderful place it is. So we actually went and checked it out for our child a couple weeks ago, met Kristen, and we're hoping this goes through because we're looking to enroll our son there. So, yeah, so I'm here to support the application. Thank you.
This is just a financial transaction for you. thanks, Patrick. Are there first-time speakers? Second-time speakers? Third-time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. So if I could have a motion to grant conditional use permit to provide no on-site parking spaces or 14 spaces is the minimum required.
So moved.
Second. Okay, discussion. just since you're the motion maker, Councilor Perkins.
Sure. I think the applicant makes a compelling case for why this is different than other requests for waivers for parking downtown. And I've been out running or walking to work, and I've sort of seen this in action, and it seems to be a pretty symbiotic situation with the businesses around it. So I think I'm in support of this.
Ms. Burrow?
On a similar point, as having had an office in that general neighborhood for 6 years, it was nice to see, one, the building actually get rebuilt, and I actually watched that process happen and watched this place open. And honestly, that is the quietest area of Portsmouth early in the morning, because there are no coffee shops and there are no places that are really open early in the morning. So the morning is definitely not a problem. I haven't heard of any complaints in the afternoon. I'm sure it's, especially in the summertime, a bit busier at noontime and even up to the 5 o'clock hour. But if there's no complaints from even any of the area businesses, then I can't see a reason why this short-term drop-off situation shouldn't be approved.
Other comments? City Manager Bohenko.
I do have concerns relative to the waiving of 14 spaces. I mean, it is a beautiful building, a great job that was done on that. It does concern, but there has been a compelling reasons that have been given, but a lot of it does deal with the person that's running the facility. When we, you know, somebody else could come in a year or two from now, and that could all change. And instead of having, you know, you could have 28 children that individually come in the morning. I just have concerns that the substantial of amount of this has been waived. But again, I have, I don't know, I just, this kind of waiver does bother me a little bit, but there has been some compelling evidence.
Mr. LeDuc.
I understand Mr. Bohenko's concerns with regards to parking, but as someone who lived in Portsmouth and took their kids to Exeter, for this, I think it's a great use of the building. I promote a school like this because we don't have it. As they mentioned, they're the only game in town. I think you have to go pretty far to find a similar service. So I get excited. I'm jealous that, you know, my kids are now 10 and 8. And so
have more kids.
Shush, my wife might be listening. you know, I understand the parking concerns, and I was going to raise that. It's a tough argument, and I get it, and it seems to be working. But there is also, you know, as some, we took our kids to Exeter, and there was a long line of cars waiting to pick up the kids at the end of the day because it didn't work the way it's working, the way it's suggested here. So it's something you have to balance. But at the end of the day, I just love the fact that what the building's being used for, and we should promote this. It's something the city needs, is, I guess, what I'm arguing for.
Other comments? Yeah, I frankly, when I saw this going in, I was a bit of a skeptic that it made sense. You've proven me wrong, and you've proven that in fact the demand's there because you have the opportunity to grow it, and the evidence shows that parking isn't required, and so I think in this case I feel personally very comfortable in waiving the request for additional because you've already been granted 10 spaces or 12 spaces by the zoning board, so you're not asking for 14 from us. You're asking two. Mm-hmm. So just to put that in context. Anything else? Jody, did you have something?
Well, I just wanted to say what many of you have already said, but I think it's a really great use of the building. I think it's very refreshing to have little kids downtown instead of, you know, usually they're tucked away in a building somewhere and you don't even know what's there, and to have it not be everything else around town, I think it's great. I've been by several times and looked in the window and seen the kids playing, and I think it's great to have a city school.
I agree. Anything else? I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Best of luck. Item C, the application is Samuel Duncan Dushkin and Nicole DeFerri, owners for property located at 149 Cass Street. Requesting conditional use permit approval to section 10.815 of the zoning ordinance to create a one-room garden cottage in an existing 19-foot by 19-foot building with a footprint of 361 square feet and a gross floor area of 351 square feet. Said property is shown in Assessor's Map 1461 as Lot 7 and lies within the general residence C district. Who's here to speak for this application?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good evening, members of the board. My name is Chris Mulligan. I'm an attorney at Bozen & Associates in Portsmouth, and I'm representing the applicants, Samuel Dushkin and Nicole DeFeo of 149 Cass Street. Mr. Dushkin is here with me, along with Sean Peters of Revision Construction, who has prepared the application and is would be doing the work if the proposal is approved. We think this is a fairly straightforward application of the garden cottage ordinance. The proposal is to simply convert an existing accessory structure that has been on the property, according to tax records from the city, since 1940, convert that into an accessory dwelling garden cottage. Staff memo indicates or sets forth fairly comprehensively, this application meets all of the required criteria for a garden cottage. Specifically, existing structure will not be expanded vertically or horizontally. In fact, there will be no significant change to the exterior of the structure at all. The proposed garden cottage will not be larger than 600 square feet gross floor area. It'll be substantially less than that, in fact. Garden cottage is within a required side yard setback. However, there are no windows or doors facing the adjacent property within that setback. So privacy concerns, we feel, will not be implicated. The primary dwelling at 149 Cass Street is Mr. Dushkin and his family's principal residence, and that will remain the case. The garden cottage and the primary dwelling will, of course, remain in common ownership. None of the utilities are separately metered or anything like that. There's no plan for anything like that, and of course, as a condition of approval, the board would obviously make or require that the that both dwellings remain in common ownership. The exterior design that's proposed is compatible with the existing residence in terms of architectural and building forms. Again, there is no proposed change to what's already existing and has been existing since for over 60, 70 years. The overall property itself provides adequate open space and landscaping useful for both the primary dwelling and the garden cottage. I think the staff memo has a very nice representation. There's an aerial photo that gives you a good idea of how much open space there is. This is actually a very large lot for this part of Cass Street, and has a very significant and quite lovely garden in the backyard, which would be available to both the primary, the occupants of the primary dwelling and the garden cottage. The garden cottage, again, maintains a compatible relationship to adjacent properties in terms of its location and design, and will not significantly reduce privacy. Once again, the structure itself is not going to undergo any drastic or significant exterior changes, and there are no windows or doors facing the adjacent property. So again, no privacy concerns should be implicated. Then finally, what's proposed will not result in excessive noise, traffic, or parking congestion. This is what's proposed is an extremely small space, so excessive noise or traffic really isn't implicated at all. And as the site plan shows, what we've proposed and what we have room for are at least four discrete parking spaces, which is more than adequate for two dwellings in this zone. So from our perspective, it meets all the criteria and standards under our ordinance for approval of a garden cottage. We hope you'll agree. And you know, I think all of the policy reasons behind promoting accessory dwellings and garden cottages are really come to fruition with this project. It's an existing structure that is easily adaptable for this use, and we hope you agree. If you have any questions, hopefully we can answer them.
Questions for the applicant? Ms. Rowe.
It's really sort of a quick, sort of easy question. Would the applicant be willing, if it was made a requirement, to extend the 6-foot fence that runs along that border?
Yes,
thank down you. And then do the tip down to the picket fence at the street?
Yes, I thank you for raising that. I apologize, I did not bring that up. That was a concern that was raised by the neighbor, the adjacent neighbor, and yes, we would be willing to stipulate or agree to a condition that a 6-foot fence would be extended where it's now a 4-foot fence.
Great. Okay.
Question. Good question, Beth. Other questions of the applicant? Thanks very much, Chris.
Thank you.
Open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. Do you want to make a motion? Thanks.
Mr. Chair, I would be happy to make a motion. First, that we vote to find the application satisfies the requirements of 10.815.40.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Can I keep going?
Yep, and I'll make a motion that we vote to grant the conditional use permit as presented with the following stipulations, which is going to be obviously the ones included in the memo, but then the added stipulation that they continue the fence along the southerly border that exists now to be 6 feet, and then maybe that last panel could be the tip down that they have now sort of before that structure can be down, because I know it goes down to a lower fence at the front yard. So I'd like to add that stipulation in.
Second.
Discussion?
I'd just like to say this is exactly what we had in mind when a garden cottage zoning was actually written. So it's nice to see,
good to see one, isn't it?
Perfect example.
Yeah, I agree. So
I have a clarification. So just on the fence, is it a 6-foot fence, or is it to be maintained at the same elevation as the 6-foot fence in the back? Because the actual elevation dips down, you know.
It does. So where that tip down is going to continue to be 6 feet until it reaches the last panel of the street.
No, the contour of the land actually dips
so
down.
Just maintain
so
the six height of the
maintain
fence.
The height of right. Maintain the height of the existing fence.
Good note.
6-foot fence.
So it's
can you do that?
Larger
it's
than
much
a six
larger,
foot,
much higher fence.
Yeah. I don't think you can do that. That's
what do you
so
mean
I'm just trying
I
to make sure, because the guy, the person who wrote the letter is showing pictures from his window. And so a 6-foot fence would only be 2 feet higher than, I guess, the 4-foot fence that's there now, as opposed to blocking.
I think it's a 3-foot fence that's there now.
Well, I'm just going off what the letter states. So
yeah, no, I have fencing in my house. This is, and this measures up with the front fencing, which is about more of a 3-foot fence than a 4-foot fence. Trust me, I'm 5 feet tall.
No, I understand. I'm just trying to get clarification for the applicant,
yeah.
So we understand what we're actually suggesting.
A question for the applicant: do you know the height of that tall fence now?
I don't actually know the exact height of the tall side of the fence, but I believe the land does grade down, as this gentleman had mentioned.
Yeah, I just need to know if you want a specific height or if you want it.
It should match the height of the highest fence that's there now.
But I think Jay's point is it might it might be higher than 6 feet. Which
yes.
We have to be careful about what
I believe it's much higher than 6 feet as you get to the closer to the street.
Depending on how that slopes.
Right.
The The issue is how tall can you go?
You're saying this land slopes down?
Yes.
So the fence would slope down with the land?
So at some point, you're talking about a 10-foot fence.
So maintaining 6 feet.
6 feet.
To the tip, okay.
Oh, that's, okay, that's different. So you're suggesting you maintain a 6-foot fence?
These scientists are just getting too difficult.
Not the same.
6-foot fence. I think that's what we're saying is 6-foot fence.
6-foot fence.
That's a standard fence, as opposed to maintaining the height of the 6-foot fence.
I would add 6-foot fence.
In the back, because then you're talking.
You're not talking about keeping it.
You're talking a wall.
Keeping it consistent.
Right.
The motion is.
That's helpful, thanks.
You have a 6-foot set fence.
And I think that's.
I thought I was clear.
Which I think what, but I'm glad you added that clarification.
Okay, thank you.
I think Jay's point is it also may not achieve quite the privacy that the abutter will want.
But it's the best we can do.
But it's the best we can do.
They would want a 12-foot fence.
Yes.
Mr. Gamester?
I guess two-part question, first for Juliet. Is there a reason why we didn't carry over the recording of the conditional use permit to the new garden cottage?
We should have.
Oh, in the new zoning that hasn't been approved yet?
Yeah, because I was just going to add a stipulation that they just record this conditional use permit if it's going to be consistent with ones that are coming up.
No, there's not. That may be something we overlooked. So the recording requirement that was
added to
documentation,
the ADUs is not in the garden.
So the 10.814.70 proposed under ADUs was not carried forward to garden cottages.
Yeah.
That probably should be.
It should be.
Okay.
Don't you think?
Yes. Do you want to revote on that? Or
The council's going to deal with it. Let the council deal with that.
Rebecca can take care of that.
Well, we'll put it in.
To make her the motion, would you be willing to add that as a stipulation?
Well, I don't know if we can yet.
I think I'll just put in my comments in the zoning.
Well, I'm not referring to that section. I'm just the ordinance, just the stipulation saying record it.
For this petition?
For this particular application. Are you good with that, Beth?
Can do that. Are we allowed to do that?
Yep.
So there's a fourth stipulation.
So what it would say is the documentation of the conditional use permit approval shall be recorded at the Rockingham County Registry of Deeds. So it's basically any format that is recordable. It doesn't have to be a deed.
Perfect.
Okay. So yes. Councilor Perkins.
This is just in the spirit of thoroughness. I'm supportive of this application, but I just want to make sure I understand why we can approve it now, even though it was denied as a variance. Is it because there was a zoning ordinance change?
Correct.
The ADU law.
Yeah, no, I just want to understand how it works.
Yeah, so previously, thank you for asking that question. So previously, this would have been considered a second dwelling unit, which wouldn't have been allowed without a variance.
Right.
Because we passed the accessory dwelling unit and garden cottage, they're now allowed to do it as an accessory dwelling unit / garden cottage in this case.
It's like a different,
it's a different use.
Yep.
And specific to that is that it has to be owner occupied, it has to be conditions set on it.
Thank you.
And that was in 2016, I think, when they went before it. And that was before we had the ADU. Yeah. Anything else?
17 is
so we have a motion with four stipulations. We have a second. I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Item D, the application of the Islamic Society of the Seacoast area owner for a property located at 686 Maplewood Ave. They've asked that this be postponed. If I can have a motion to postpone.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Can I actually ask Juliet a question on this?
Sure.
I had some questions around what, I know there's a lot of questions around the parking yesterday, but are we able to tell them which plan we, I mean, because they're going with two totally opposite studies saying parking's either 156 or 78, which is half of that. I just didn't know if we're not able to do that.
Well, okay. No, but you can ask them to do,
right.
They are allowed to use the method that is a minimum. And they're allowed to do that.
I would suggest when that gets presented to us, we can ask those sorts of questions, but I don't think it's.
Just was curious. But if they can use as of right, they could use either option.
Should we save this, Juliet? These materials?
Please save those materials.
Yeah. That goes in the save pile.
We're a high maintenance crew tonight.
Thank you for clarifying that in the record, Juliet.
Goldie.
So,
I thought it was fascinating that our partner did.
Item E, the application of the City of Portsmouth, New Hampshire, owner for property located at 125 Cottage Street, requesting site plan approval for adaptive reuse and renovations of the former U.S. Army Reserve Center into a senior activity center, and a front entry addition with a footprint and gross floor area of 150 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 174 as Lot 15 and lies within the municipal district. Who's here to speak for this application?
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board. My name is Bryn Sullivan. I am the Senior Services Supervisor for the City of Portsmouth as part of the Recreation Department. Also here tonight, we have Tim Nichols from AECM Architects and Engineers, and we have Ben, I forget your last name, Clark, also from AECM, to speak about the technical aspects of this project.
So?
Presentation.
Go for it.
Plans are right on the screen.
All
right.
Take us through the
Tim will take
application.
It away.
Tell us what we need to know.
Ready, set, go.
Right.
Good evening, Chairman, members. So a quick timeline evolution of the project. We got involved back in 2015 to develop some concepts for the potential reuse, redevelopment of this former U.S. Army Reserve Center. About a year and a half ago, we were engaged by the city to commence actual design for adaptive reuse of the facility, primarily for senior activity center functions. So the real design objective was to accommodate the existing senior activity center functions in a new modern space. That design process has involved several design reviews with city departments, including DPW, fire, and recreation. We've had presentations with the senior activity center and group. We have had a butter meeting, which the city coordinated end of October. And we recently had the TAC review meeting where we received comments and have addressed those in the package that you have now. So basis of design, obviously we wanted to afford a modern facility that meets current and future uses for the Senior Activity Center and other potential multi-generational community uses. Accessibility and waypointing was very important. Life safety, meeting modern code requirements for the building and for the site. Sustainability, sustainable building practices, including site design measures. Historic, there were originally some historic deed restrictions on the property, but those have did not get conveyed in the deed process. But throughout the design, we've been sensitive to some of those historic, more significant historic characteristics of the building. And then obviously future uses. Whatever we do now, we don't want to be choice limiting in any future redevelopment of the site. So the adaptive reuse, the design that's in front of you, involves site infrastructure, utilities, driveways, pedestrian access, lighting, waypointing, landscaping. It includes a new entry addition, a very small structure to the front of the building, which really provides an appealing entry into the building, which it was lacking. Or does lack. Renovation of the interior building. So a complete renovation of the interior, all new building systems, including electrical, mechanical, HVAC, lighting, and all new finishes, flooring, walls, some interior wall removal and addition. And then the outdoor space connections and landscape enhancements. So trying to create some outdoor connectivity and use to the building now, and hoping that future phases will enhance that. So we hope that you find the plans acceptable, and I'm happy to answer any technical questions.
There also is a pointer next to you that if you want to advance to any of the slides, you can use that.
Okay.
It's the silver thing. But if you get questions.
Questions for the applicant.
Okay.
Ms. Moreau.
So when we were talking about the buildings right next door that are about to be torn down and medical buildings built, so the ones that run along the bypass, there is an easement, I believe, already existing onto that property. And so we had talked about the fact that since this is going to be a senior center and they're going to be medical buildings, wouldn't it be nice if they didn't have to go back out to Cottage Street if they were had a doctor's appointment right next door? If there, have you thought about any sort of access in the back that would actually link up to that new project that's going to get started?
Yes. Unfortunately, that's not something we can do in this existing phase, but in future phases, as the site gets more developed, that would certainly be something to evaluate.
I'll keep asking.
Other questions to the applicant?
As I get older.
Right, as it becomes more relevant.
Exactly.
Maybe I should be asking.
I'm going to be old enough next year.
So, yes, Mr. LeDuc.
Well, just on that notion, I guess your site plan shows like a chain link fence between the two properties that Ms. Moreau was referencing. Is that an existing fence that you plan to keep there, or is it a fence that you plan to construct? I can't.
That's an existing fence.
That's an existing
that
fence.
Will remain. We are removing the barbed wire strands from the fence, but
so we can take a look at probably putting a gate in. I believe that's a dentist's office that's going to be there. So certainly, if there's a lot of patients, that we'd take a look at that and put in a gate. I don't think that would be.
It's a medical office with a mix of medical office
And residential.
No. I mean, it's dentist, but also other medical.
Other medical.
It's all medical. Yeah.
It's all medical. Okay.
Other questions for the applicant? Thank you. I'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers? Third time speakers? Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chair, I'd make a motion that we vote to grant site plan approval with the stipulations to be completed prior to the issuance of the building permit included in the memo.
You have a second?
Second.
Discussion.
Just let the board know we started working on this project in 2005. It took the Army that long to convey the property to us. And we're just so happy that we're here tonight.
Personally, I am too.
I think we all are.
it's a great job for the city.
Yes, it's going to be nice.
Your patience was well rewarded. Any other comments? We have a motion to second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes. Thank you. Good luck.
Beth has to go to her doctor's appointment.
Item F, the application of 2422 Lafayette Road Associates LLC owner for property located at 2454 Lafayette Road, requesting amended site approval to construct three restaurant buildings. Proposed building number one, 5,000 square foot footprint and gross floor area. Proposed building number two, 1,600 square foot footprint and gross floor area. Proposed building number three, 2,310 square feet footprint and gross floor area with related green space and associated site improvements with an existing plaza parking area. Said property is shown on Assessor's Map 273 as Lot 3 and lies within the Gateway Corridor District. Who's here to speak for this application?
Thank you. Patrick Crimmins with Tie and Bond. Also here with me this evening is Doug Richardson with Waterstone Properties, the owner and applicant of the project. We're here this evening seeking a site plan amendment for Portsmouth Green, formerly known as Southgate Plaza. It's a project that's been before the board a number of times through the years, dating back to, I think, 2009, when it was a pretty tired plaza, old Shaw's, and I think an abandoned Ames building at that time. But over the years, Waterstone has done a good job kind of refurbishing it and bringing it up to a modern retail plaza. Most recently, here before you folks, back in 2016 for another site plan amendment, which included the Viridian Apartments, that 95 or so apartment units in the back of the plaza that has since been constructed and is actually very successful over at the plaza. So with the residential complete now, they're shifting their focus back to the retail plaza and then really kind of tying that all together. So we're here for a few amendments, one being the, there's no light on this, right? Oops, sorry. You can probably see this, I actually included a overlay exhibit in red on top of the old site plan of what the changes are, but up to the north corner there, next to the existing retail strip, there was once previously proposed as a 4,000 square foot building. We're seeking to increase that to a 5,000 square foot building. There is a tenant that they have a letter of intent with to enter into with that building and need that additional square footage. So there's some minor modifications to the parking area around it to increase that building and sidewalks. At the entry, the prior plan, you can see, had two 2,000 square foot spaces that flanked a park on either side as you entered from Lafayette Road. The proposal there is to take...
Sorry to interrupt you, but that slide is later on if you want to refer to
it. Oh, okay.
It's just, you have to scroll sorry through a number of other slides. It's your option if you want to...
No, thank you, Juliet. That's great. There you go.
Keep going.
There we go. Perfect, thank you. So at the entry there, under, you can see in the gray background there, the prior approval, which had the two separated buildings that flanked the park on either side. The proposal here is to combine those buildings to the center and make them one building with the park and some patio area surrounding it to the rear. I think you can see in the renderings, they already have an agreement with the national chain to go into that one of those spaces. You know, the revision is going to, you know, from a leasing standpoint, really helps because that chain, it gives them visibility as you enter into the plaza. Also, the anchor tenant, the cinema in the back, it gives them a view corridor from Route 1. And also, you can see there that Big Lots still exists. They are they will be leaving the plaza in February, and the applicant has another exciting restaurant entertainment tenant that will be occupying that space. So that'll give them a view corridor Route 1. So there's some changes there. Also, with respect to the open space adjacent to Big Lots there, we had previously shown a number of bike racks along that. We're proposing to now disperse those throughout the plaza. It's probably better practice anyways, because the different visitors to the different stores will have the ability to park their bikes closer. But the main reason being is that new tenant is looking to utilize that space, so as an open space area. So we presented to TAC earlier this month and received a recommendation for approval with I believe five stipulations, four of which were pretty minor in nature, and I believe we've addressed I think stipulation four was probably the biggest one. The request was to prove let me get the exact wording in front of me, but it's relative to the changing of the park and why we are consolidating the buildings and creating that space. So what we had included in the packets was a package that was prepared by the applicant that explains how they plan to disperse the activities throughout the plaza to the different spaces, and we kind of highlighted those different spaces that were identified in that memorandum. In addition to that, we've provided some material for a plaza that the applicant owns and operates in Rochester, where they actually have similar community activities, just to kind of demonstrate the types of things that they are looking to do at this plaza throughout those different spaces, and even the Brickyard over in Epping, the applicant also owns that as well. They recently had a Halloween event there, very similar community event that was very successful. They're looking to do those types of things here. So that is the reason for the change. It's, you know, not just the leasing, but the idea to kind of spread out the community activity throughout the plaza. So with that, Doug and I are happy to take questions.
Questions for the applicant?
Yeah, Ms. Walker.
Could you go to the next, I think it's two more slides forward, where you talked about keep going to the plan. Could you walk us through the programming?
Sure. Starting in the rear of the cinema there, actually what they've since done is, if you go back there, it's a gated dog park that is there to support the residences, and if any visitors to the plaza, in fact, have pets as well, could use it. I was actually out there the other day just to check it out myself, and there was a number of residents back there. We have the green space, large green space in front of the Viridian, which was utilized quite a bit over the summer. The space that I mentioned adjacent to Big Lots, which that tenant will look to utilize, with like cornhole games and other outdoor activities, and even the ability there and that to have like movie nights on the cinema. They do that actually over, I think it's in their, is it Epping? Rochester Plaza as well. So they have movie nights and those kinds of spaces. And then the similar, just different community activities in the two smaller spaces that, one adjacent to both of those, the proposed 5,000 square foot building that was previously approved as 4,000. And again, a smaller space at the entry where there's probably, more traffic entering. So the ability to kind of disperse the activities throughout and focus throughout the plaza.
So what's the total impact on green space with this
so I think it's
change?
So I think the impact I mentioned, it's approximately 2,500 square feet.
A reduction of 2,500
square
feet?
Yep. But we still meet the requirements of the pedestrian-oriented space and open space requirements of the Gateway Plan development.
So, and that's another clarification, is previous, this is still vested to the previous zoning. So there's no community space requirement, which.
Ms. Moreau.
It's not so much a question as a comment. I am disappointed. I was really looking forward to the large green space as you drive in to make that seem very open. That's the plans that we had previously seen. Mm-hmm. I find this, you say, gives other places corridors. I feel like it actually blocks places off a little bit more, but maybe I will think differently once it's built, but it's a little bit of a disappointment.
Yeah, I'll echo that. I mean, one of the compelling, I mean, firstly, this was our first attempt as a city to have sort of an apartment complex in a commercial space. Mm-hmm. And I think you guys have done a great job. I mean, I find the apartment complex actually attractive. I think what you've done in the first phases has been attractive. But frankly, what I was waiting for, because it was compelling, I mean, it was compelling when you presented it, was a big green open space that would be activated on either end by restaurants. And fundamentally, you sort of blew it up and you have small pieces now. And it's just not as compelling. And if this were in front of us the first time, I think the reception might have been, for at least for me, different, I can tell you. So it's not a question, it's a comment. But this is, in my mind, a big change from what you guys pitched to us 2 years ago. It's a big change. So just any other comments or questions?
Again, I would echo that, too, because I remember this coming before the board, as well as the staff review of it. And a lot of it was a lot of excitement about that type of use and how it was going to be laid out. And I'm really disappointed. Wow. Okay.
Other comments or Mr. Canister?
Yeah, for Pat and Juliet, can you just walk through the need for the parking requirements of the site as a whole, and
I think that the applicant would do a better job of that, because frankly, that was something that they have a lot of parking obligations for existing tenants, and there's a lot of cross easements. I believe there was an exhibit in one of our previous reviews that showed that obligation. So I think they definitely are meeting our parking requirements, and I believe they may actually far exceed them, but I think the reality is they have some existing obligations they have to meet. Is that
right? The two primary exhibits that are in place are a protected zone for the movie theater, a protected zone for McKinnon's, Fortunately, with Big Lots coming out, we'll be able to modify that older one. But as Patrick mentioned, we have a entertainment family use that is going to be going into the Big Lots. We're about ready to announce that lease commencement. Also, as Patrick said, we're going to engage that green space that's between the theater and the Big Lots. There'll be glass overhead doors, very similar to Muse. There'll be an outdoor patio. And also, there is a grass space that used to go to the playhouse or the jumping facility that we don't need anymore. So that'll be grassed, and we'll be doing a movie screen on the wall of the theater. That way, because of families, and typically young families come to our Rochester for the movie night, we didn't want it focused up at the main entrance with the traffic coming in and out. That felt a more safer area to be able to also have it a little more quieter. Music events will be held at the other green space between the two restaurants. But as Patrick had in the package, we currently do this in Rochester, New Hampshire, and the green space that we have there is about the size of what's between the two restaurants. So there is a lot more green space here.
Ms. Burrow?
I'm just confused by what you just said. You said there's the green space between the two restaurants, but now the two restaurants are shoved together, if you're talking about the ones by the entrance.
The green space
is on other side.
I'm talking on the northern edge against Water Country, where we're proposing a 5,000 square foot brew pub.
Okay, so that other one. That's where it was like, we used to have a big green space between those two.
Other question? Councilor Perkins?
Yeah, I guess I would just, maybe I'm not quite as disappointed as everybody else, because you know, frankly, I don't know that I would have gone to hang out on a green space right in front of a big major traffic light and intersection. But I think if these spaces are done thoughtfully, that they can still be very valuable. And I think, frankly, it's in your interest to do that, because it's going to make your whole development more successful. So,
absolutely. The Halloween event over in Epping had in excess of 1,000 people. So it creates good traffic for the center. It helps the restaurants. And, you know, open air shopping centers are evolving. We all know it. There's a much more food and entertainment aspect of them rather than traditional retail. So we've been very fortunate to have some of those elements coming to the center, and to have a national restaurant that also focuses on, you know, quick serve for the lunchtime crowd is really good complement for the other stuff we have in the center.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess that's my comment, is just, you know, the zoning is what it is, so it would be great if those are, you know, quality spaces that are useful to your residents.
Ms. Walker?
Yes.
So I have a question related to the design. I think was largely driven by the tenant, Chipotle, correct?
Correct.
So
traditionally, they would be closer on a Route 1 corridor, but they were attracted to our center in terms of the other elements that they would be with rather than a standalone.
So you've had turnover at that plaza?
Oh, absolutely. We're currently going through it now.
I guess my concern is how much will it change if that tenant changes in the near future? Is this the kind of requirement that other similar restaurants are going to want?
Oh, absolutely. The infrastructure that's placed in is pretty consistent in the city of Portsmouth from restaurant to restaurant. We actually have a other space in that building that we already have a commitment, that we have a letter of intent for more of a salad oriented type of tenant. So yes, they would be designed to be functional as other uses down the road. We don't want to have it specific, but also if you look at the exterior elevations, it's not a chain prototype. We've been very careful in the center to have not only variety but really unique architectural styles in the project.
Other questions for the applicant? Thank you, Doug.
Thank you.
Thanks, Patrick. I'll open it up to public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come to the podium. Second time speakers. Third time speakers. You know, and rise, I close the public hearing. So what's the wish of the board? I'll just ask. I'll ask for a motion to grant amended site approval so we can, if we can get a second, then we can have a discussion.
I will make a motion that we vote to grant the amended site plan approval with the included stipulation prior to issuing the building permit.
Second.
All right, so discussion? Yeah, you want to kick it off?
Sorry, since I made the motion. As disappointed as I am by the changes, I do appreciate Councilor Perkins' comments and the other comments that were made that maybe being farther away from the road and being quiet. I mean, it's, I get that, but in the summertime, it's going to be loud no matter what because it's so close to water country. I'm not sure how there's any peace and quiet. So that's just a whole other kind of noise. I hope it works out. I will vote in favor of it. I don't see any other plan that would work any better, and I don't know if forcing people to do what used to be there, if it's not going to work to get the tenants in there, then it's not going to make it successful, so.
City Manager Bohenko.
I'm just a little concerned with the traffic circulation. Maybe you could go over that a little bit for me as you come in the entry and what.
I can comment on that.
Oh, sure.
City Manager. The TAC was, there was some discussion back and forth about how we felt about these revisions in general. And I would say that one of the positive comments about this revision was that the traffic flow was a little
better.
The TAC felt it was a little better than having a big
better
island.
Than what?
Than having a big island that they had to go around and the truck turning templates. If you wanted to have Patrick comment on that. But I think that was one area that we were sort of
still tough.
Relatively in agreement, the traffic circulation was probably better as a result of this change.
Right, but it's still going to be difficult, I think.
Patrick, do you have any input?
I just would second what Juliet had mentioned. You know, we had extended that. We were forcing cars to two drives along the storefronts, where now we have the opportunity to kind of disperse that traffic a little bit throughout the parking lot and give them better access into the parking area so we're not forcing all the traffic right in front of the storefronts.
Thanks. Other comments?
Amend my motion.
Yes.
I forgot that because in the details you're using silt fence. Can you please use silt sock if it's necessary?
Oh yes, sorry. That's just an old detail that's been carried over.
I went and circled it and then I totally missed it.
Yeah. No, it's just an old detail that was carried over through the old plans. Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
John would be very upset.
He would be very upset if I missed, even before I circled it.
I'm surprised he didn't text you. Other comments?
Colby, are you okay with second on that?
Yes, yeah, I am.
Okay.
All
right. So I'll call the motion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? I'm opposed. So one opposed.
Motion.
I'm opposed, yeah. Motion passes.
Thank you.
8-1. Thank you.
Oh, good. It's good to know that when I talk, something happens.
And you know what?
I can see that.
It didn't help.
I just was so excited about plan four. It's hard to.
I know, but still.
Accept any changes.
Yeah.
Okay. Item 8, preliminary conceptual consultation. Item A.
Actually, have to take any action on this item.
No, I'm just going to read it into the record.
Thank you.
The application of Torrington Properties, Inc. and Waterstone Property Group, Inc. applicants for property located at 428 Route 1 Bypass. They've asked that be postponed. No votes necessary on that. And item B, the application of Redgate on behalf of Sobo Square, LLC applicants for property located at 62 Daniel Street, the McIntyre Building, requesting preliminary conceptual consultation review for mixed-use developments. Who's going to take us through this?
Good evening. My name is Steve Perdue. I work with Redgate. We are partnered with the Kane Company to redevelop the McIntyre project. We are also partnered with the City of Portsmouth in a very unique partnership where we are attempting to obtain this property through the Historic Monument Program that's administered by the National Park Service. The property is a historic resource. And the project that we're proposing
is one that would redevelop the entire property, not just the historic asset. I'm sure that many of you are aware of the progress in the McIntyre project over the last year. It's certainly been tremendous to see how the community has come together to inform the project and shape the design. And we're really thrilled to be in front of you tonight to give you an update on that and to get your feedback on the next steps. There are really three major components to the project. The first is the McIntyre building itself. What we're planning to do is a complete renovation and selective restoration of this building. That means we're going to basically redo the interior of the building and convert it into Class A office and retail space. Today, the building functions essentially as an office building upstairs and as an office lobby and post office downstairs. So we intend to basically keep the same uses upstairs as office and to have commercial ground floor uses. The second component to the project is new construction. It's 77 residential apartments and 77 parking spaces and retail space at the ground floor. And the third major component of the project is that nearly half the site is programmed, finished public open space, a series of plaza spaces that are connected by pathways, which also connect the site to its broader context. The plan that you see here is the lower level plan. There's quite a topographical change across the site from Daniel Street to Bow Street, almost a floor. And so the plan that you see here is a lower level plan that fronts Bow Plaza. We're planning to have a couple of retail spaces that will front the plaza, and this lower level will also contain the garage space for parking for the residential. The main ground floor plan will include a number of retail spaces, both in the McIntyre building and in the new residential buildings. And these spaces are adjacent to and front new plaza spaces, a renovated plaza at Daniel Street, a central plaza in the middle of the project, which also connects the center of the area and Penhallow Street up through to Chapel Street, as well as a passage that gets you from the central plaza down to Bow Plaza. And all of the central area fronts an interior community space that the project has dedicated for public use. We've developed a number of images that I think help visualize some of the exciting concepts that the community has come together to design with our team. This is Bow Plaza as viewed from Market Square. This is a view from the passage through to the central plaza space. You can see the community space inside the building here. And this is a view from Penhallow towards the St. John's Church and our central plaza space. We've been working closely with the National Park Service to make sure that the design of the project is something that they would ultimately approve. So we've been working closely with them. There are a number of things that we are planning to do in terms of how the project deals with local land use planning regulations. So for example, the project is intended to meet zoning standards 100%. We've been meeting with the HDC. We've had a couple of meetings with them. We're planning to meet with them again in early January to continue the conversation. And I think we're intending to essentially go through the planning board process, TAC, in February and March, and hope to be on the March planning board hearing of early next year.
So questions for the applicant or comments? Ms. Moreau?
I have a few. How many existing parking spaces are available, like in the garage area? I'm assuming you're reusing the underground garage parking they have now or expanding on that. So I was just curious as to the size of it now, and you're saying 77 parking spaces. Are those all in that space?
Yes, there's currently 44 spaces in the garage today. Mm-hmm. We're planning to add stacking technology in there to get essentially 77 spaces within the garage.
Okay.
We're going to maintain the parallel parking spaces around the site that are there today.
Okay. I actually worked on Bow Street for 6 years, so I'm very familiar with the site. And so I was very excited that I just finally noticed you're actually putting stairs going up to like towards St. John's Church. Because
yes.
I know that is a huge incline between the two levels. So do you now have permission to be able to have a pedestrian, like sort of, I know there's a road that's city owned there, but there's also two parking spaces there. So is it going to go up into the parking lot of the church, or is it going to go up into the road that goes out to Chapel?
So there is a road there. There's a public way.
It's Chapel Court.
Yeah, Chapel Court. And I don't know definitively if Chapel Court connects to the property line.
Okay.
100%. So if it doesn't, I think we'd be seeking to make that connection. If it does, I think we'd be all set.
General comments, I love the fact that you have light and air going through it, and the public spaces are great. I was a big fan of the McIntyre building continuing to be office space because there isn't enough office space downtown. But one of the downsides that actually push people out of downtown and office space is the lack of parking. So if it's the 77 spots are all going to the residential use, I really wisely ask you to consider trying to find a parking situation for your office tenants, because the tenants that want to be downtown, that want to have that face, if they're I left downtown in the spring because I'm an attorney and my clients could never find parking to come to my office. So it is a huge problem, especially in that area. It's very tight. I can tell you at 3 or 4 o'clock and a Thursday or Friday afternoon in July and August, you're not getting anywhere near that area, mostly because of Prescott Park has a lot going on. So every spot's taken. So in order to truly attract, I think, the clientele that you're going to want in the office building, seriously consider carving out some parking, even if it's just guest parking for their clients and maybe their workers have to find parking somewhere else. I advise you to really try to do that.
Are there comments or questions for the applicant? Yeah, so I'd ask if you needed to get, maybe you guys haven't done this work yet, but I'd ask you to think about it for the next go around. If to echo what Beth's saying, if you needed to get more than 77 spaces, how would you do it? And I understand that a lot of other cities are using the stack technology, and it's wildly successful. It would be a first for Portsmouth, and so I'm assuming it would be as successful here. But I would ask you to think about how you could have more spaces to support your tenants and to support the need of the residential units, because I know it's premature now to talk about the size of those units and whether in fact that 77 meets the required ordinance or not. But if 77 is the maximum you can get with a stacking technology, I'd ask you to think about other opportunities to have additional parking to support both the requirement for residential units as well as for some of the commercial space.
We'll definitely explore that.
Thank you. Mr. Clark.
I guess just from a site layout, I know this is, you know, you guys have put a lot of effort into this and there's been a lot of work on this. But just kind of just some general comments from my point of view, I guess, is I really enjoy the sight lines coming down Pentallo Street. As you look towards Bow Street, you can see pretty much over all the buildings. You can see the industrial sector and stuff, and it really kind of ties things together. So, you know, having, I guess, just from a site layout, the Bow Street Resident B building, you know, kind of, to me, it kind of just, you know, throws a wrench in that a little bit. I guess you could probably put me in the camp of, you know, the folks that wanted to see just a giant green space out there. But I guess I would, you know, if you were to combine that building with the other building, I think is fine. It's, you know, steps up. There's a lot of grade change there. That's, you know, it's not a problem. I'm not a huge fan of tight corridors. alleyways, that's the passageways, I guess you call them, just because, you know, you're just kind of in a tunnel to some degree. And, you know, I guess I just always kind of envisioned this when it was first coming out, as you would enter what you call the Bow Plaza and kind of step up into the plaza in the center, which you still would do up that passageway. But certainly, you know, I always enjoy coming down Penn Hollow Street and just kind of seeing all of Bow Street kind of laid out in front of me. I've always enjoyed that. So anyways, you know, I know things are progressing, but just food for thought.
Other feedback? So I'd actually, just to counter Corey, I actually don't personally feel the need for green space here. And I think you have an urban landscape that potentially can be very attractive and activated. And there's just a short walk to get to Prescott Park from here, and a short walk that will get you to future green space at the Wentworth parking area that is proposed to be
Worth
area that's proposed to be green space. So the idea that this absolutely needs to be green space, in my mind, just isn't consistent with what we have around this. So I actually appreciate the design you have. I do worry about the parking a lot. A lot. And I know you guys in the city, has been the council, you guys put a lot of work in the design. You've been responsive to feedback you've gotten through residents, and I'm appreciative of that. I think overall, in my mind, it's a pretty solid design and layout.
So it's a really tight site, believe it or not. It's only a couple of acres. A couple of acres in Portsmouth is a lot, right? But it is a tight site, and I think we've worked really hard to get the density that we need for financial feasibility, provide covered, concealed parking, which it was really important to the community, and do all of the above, right? So it's been a challenge. I think we do have some things we've been thinking about for additional parking. We can explore it.
Mm-hmm.
I also wanted to mention that I have Patrick Crimmins from Ty and Bond, our civil engineer, who's been thinking about the parking and traffic most recently. He's here for questions, as well as Lisa DiStefano, who's working on the architectural team.
Other feedback, the applicant?
No, I just really feel parking is gonna be the biggest issue. I mean, maybe even, is it possible to extend the garage out more? I mean, it dips way down when you get to Bow Street. And I know there's the ramps that go down there, but you know, that other parking lot they had even sinks slower than where Bow Street is. So I wonder if you could just dig that out a little bit more and get yourself a larger garage that way without too much difficulty.
Yeah, it's interesting.
It sounds easy to make.
Yeah.
Just dig that out a little bit.
There's a lot of rocks down there.
There's a lot of levels. I mean, it's a hike to walk around that neighborhood. It's like hill up Chapel.
It's definitely a big rocky hill, but I think that this area right here, so the priority has always been to try to activate Bow Street with as much retail as possible. So we've really limited the frontage for access to the garage here.
Mm-hmm.
And if we were to, we could extend the garage, but I think it would really limit the retail. And then you'd have sort of garage facing Bow Plaza.
No, I don't want the garage facing it. I want it to be under the retail.
Yes, it's it's definitely cost prohibitive, given the low density we have on the site.
Well, it's pie in the sky idea, right?
It's conceptual.
It's a concept.
So
we can all go out there and get our shovels and start helping to dig.
Anything
right?
else?
There's a 77. You haven't dedicated it.
You guys good for now? We'll see this again. I hope the feedback's been helpful to you. And we appreciate you guys presenting to me.
It's definitely helpful, and I appreciate you guys' time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're done there. So other business.
So the only item under other business was talking about.
And we have this request for.
No, the extension of the subdivision for 2 Kearsarge Way can be done administratively by the.
Oh, okay. So we don't. You don't need to do that then. Okay.
The other business item was for the January meeting, having a potential second meeting after the regularly scheduled meeting. I think it would be, so it would be the 24th.
You're killing me.
The request was, the chair and a few others had brought up a desire to sort of have a discussion about the transportation analysis that's been done related to the Kate Street corridor, proposed Kate Street connector, and we have done some analysis in response to the proposed 105 Bartlett Street project, as well as to the Frank Jones Center. So we could talk about that. We could talk about the CIP items that we talked about, that we went over tonight, and sort of how that all relates, and some of the potential benefits of having that connector road, and talk about any issues that the concerns that the planning board members have. And I would say we have been continuing to talk to the 428 Route 1 bypass, the Frank Jones Center folks. I think they would like to come back for another preliminary conceptual consultation with you in response to some of the comments you had presented to them at the last meeting related to workforce housing. So if we did a second meeting and wanted to have the preliminary conceptual consultation at the same time as the transportation work session,
yeah, that makes sense.
That might make sense. Also wouldn't put them on the last item on the agenda when we're
all
tired.
That would be nice.
Yeah. So anyway, so those were my suggestions. it obviously means you have to agree to a second meeting, Jane.
Well, I think I would ask you to poll the board to see availability on the 24th.
Sure.
And if we have a appropriate response, then we have a second meeting on the 24th. I do like the idea of covering those two items, the work session first, and then having them come in for,
okay,
for more.
All right.
The other thing I would ask a staff, and it's consistent with that particular application, but more broadly, is if, Juliet, you could conduct a sort of a financial and economic analysis of our revised workforce housing ordinance that suggests 20% affordable units and the appropriate rental associated with that. Just as I know you did some preliminary work when that was done, but maybe there's been more experience now.
Mm-hmm.
In other towns and cities, and we can learn more. I think as we go forward, it will help the board maybe make more informed decisions. So if you would be willing to have staff do that analysis and bring it back at some point, that'd be great. Anything else? Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, aye. Thank you.
Aye.
Thanks, guys.
Second.
Demolition for the 23rd.